Testing 1, 2, 3. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 11, 12.
Time you gonna have to leave, Jack?
Oh, I guess about 20 minutes. 12.
All right, well, we'll go ahead and we'll try to move this thing along as fast as we can. We got a number of items here that we want to get some official action on. One is the constitutional amendment that you just read, which simply extends the time from 5 days to 15 days that the governor has to consider bills after the legislature's adjourned. And as I view the matter, I think it is a good constitutional amendment, because I don't think that 5 days is enough time for the governor and his staff over there to review all those bills. Apparently.
Boy, they turned them out a few days there at the closing session.
Right.
Almost an impossibility.
Yeah.
It still, it doesn't take anything.
No, it's, as far as I can determine, it, the only language it changes is the number of days, from five to 15 days. I think the other language is already in the Constitution.
The bill still becomes law. He doesn't do anything with it.
Yeah.
That's one important feature, obviously.
Yeah. You want
a motion?
Yeah, let's.
For a motion.
All right.
We
support it. The Constitution Amendment.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried, and so ordered. I've got a number of items jotted down here. Some of them I don't think will take too much time. One, you know, we've been in support of the Mississippi Council on Economic Education, and we've been trying to raise some money to finance the project. Robbie, Jack, we set up appointed a committee at the request of the Lieutenant Governor of Labor Representatives, Jack, John Erickson, James Jackson, and getting all else is on that committee. But anyhow, we got a good labor representative group, and we had a meeting of the State Finance Committee over here a few weeks ago. Everybody agreed we'd put on a fundraising campaign to raise money to put these seminars, these workshops on the campuses of the universities to bring in teachers and teach them the rudiments of the system, you know. So the question here today is, how much do you feel that the State Council ought to contribute? Now, before we really get into it, let me explain this to you. We've got two distinct groups, the Clergy Council and the Council on Economic Education. And up until this year, we put on separate fundraising drives for the two groups, one for the clergy and one for the other. And the same people that's responsible for the Council on Economic Education have also been responsible for the Clergy Council. You know, I ain't the same people. So we've all agreed that the sensible thing to do is to put on one fundraising drive and finance both of them instead of putting on a separate one. So whatever money is raised, in other words, the Clergy Council will be financed out of the money that the current drive. Of course, I know Jack understands this, so I thought I'd explain it to Robin. Now, we've made a contribution ever since this started to each one, right, Tom?
Yeah.
Do you remember what it's been running?
About we made a contribution of $200 to one and three to the other, wasn't it, Carolyn, or what? Somewhere in the two or three.
Well, it's run somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 or a little better. You know what I'm talking about. If we kick in, say, $500, it won't be in excess of what we've been doing. You know what I'm talking about. Well, I'm convinced that this is one of the most urgent things that we need to do, is this matter of economic education. And just like this group of school teachers I met with in Clarksdale the other day. You know, it's appalling, really. Yeah, this was elementary and high school teachers, about 35 of them. And when we got into this thing, as you know, there wasn't but a couple of them had much of an understanding how the system operates. I had one young school teacher tell me after this meeting was over with, he says, I went to college for 4 years, and I learned more this afternoon about how our system operates than I learned for the 4 years I went to college. Now, that's school teachers we're talking about now. If the school teachers themselves don't understand the system, how do we expect them to teach it to the kids?
I think what also
going
on is real attention. He put it down on the elementary grade level where they can understand what he's talking about.
Right.
Of course, this was principal of the group. I believe, I didn't see an active registration account, but the lady that was on the registration desk said it was 35 registered when I was there. And they were from Hattiesburg, Natchez.
White and black.
White and black. Predominantly black. There was some white there too. I thought it was real good.
Well, you met Dr. Ellis down there.
Right.
He's the guy set this one up, and I had a chance to chat with him a little ahead of time. Of course, he had to leave right after we got started, but you know, he's been doing a pretty good job on his own up there. He's been coming to a little money, some federal funds, and he's had a series of workshops seminars going on already. He's probably done more than anybody else in this area. But I'm convinced that it's something that's, well, we might be too late with it, as a matter of fact, before as the kids are concerned. You know, I'm convinced in my own mind a lot of this dissension on the college campuses, the youth and all, can be traced to the fact that a lot of them don't have any concept of how the system operates. Well, y'all want to make a contribution?
I'd offer a motion we contribute $500.
Second, of course, we're going to be taking this question.
Mm-hmm.
That's second. I started to make an observation and more or less ask a question. I said that we'd make that under discussion.
Well, go ahead.
I was going to ask Derek, in relation to what Jackson earlier, if we can afford it, what's the opinion?
Well, we can afford it, I think, because our projected budget that we've worked on here, we anticipate a certain amount of contributions, and we can balance. I mean, this will actually, I think, be less than what we've been putting into the total program. I think we kicked in a little more than 500, both of them, so actually we'll be saving a little of what we've been doing.
Maybe I'll hope for you.
Well, here's what I was going to tell you. We've already got $975 in here as a result of our communications and fundraising efforts through the committee. So this will push it be 14. If we put in 500, be 14,750. So that's three or four times as much as we collected from labor before.
That'll almost take care of the needed funds for the clergy.
Yeah. Well. Now, what I thought I'd do, well, let's dispose of the motion, though. You want to discuss it further?
Yeah.
You don't?
Yeah.
All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Now, what I thought I'd do on this thing, if it meets your approval, I'm going to get a hold of Ben Lampton down at the First National Bank, who is the treasurer of the council. And I thought I'd talk with this fellow Spell, who's with the Gottman Agency. I think we might try to get a little publicity out of this when I turn these checks over to them. And this in itself might spur some of these business groups and what have you to come on through with their money.
Mm-hmm.
We got an Anderson thing going on now. I'll just kind of deviate briefly from the subject at hand to tell you about an interesting situation that has developed as a result of our participation in this highly handicapped contest. Statewide, you know, we've been paying expenses for the winner of this contest to Washington. And all of a sudden, there's been a lot of interest developed on the part of certain business people to participate in this program. We just had a meeting the other day. I got pictures of all this. The Sheraton hotel chain, the Umbertas, who used to be in Heidelberg, was over. They're picking up the tab on the hotel. They're going to provide them with a room. And they're going a little further than just the contest winner. They're extending this to the, I believe, to the kid's teacher, counselor.
The principal.
And then we got the, Mississippi School Supply. They're in on the act. You see what I'm talking about? So this thing is getting to be rather lucrative. And I'm convinced in my own mind the reason that this is happening is because they can't stand to see us pick up the public relations in this thing without them being there. So what I had in mind on this, you see, that maybe we can spur them into coming through with some money on this thing if we get a little publicity out of it.
Well, they can't collude us, so they'll have to drive.
We've really got them on the spot here on a couple of things.
Well, it was a Friday, and I thought Wednesday afternoon, after I got home, I had a call from some guy that I'd never heard of before on the subject of hiring the handicap down there. I didn't know what called the office after I left that Wednesday afternoon, and of course, the Anson service took the message and called me at home on it.
Yeah.
But I knew he'd return the call, it was too darn late, and didn't know what he was talking about anyway. Her to get away, so I never returned the call. And so maybe you contact me again. I know more about what he's talking about then.
Yeah.
From this explanation.
Well, the winner this time was another young lady from Louisville School. This is 2 years in a row that the winner's come from that particular school. For a while, it was Hattiesburg. You know.
Mm-hmm.
We had two from Hattiesburg, and I jumped up to Louisville. Was they having a meeting of the bunch of people's going up to the president's meeting on this thing. I didn't think it was an appointment. And us going just to go up to attend that type of thing. But there's quite a few members of the governor's committee that's going up to attend the gala affair. You know, I got some correspondence on it in there yesterday. But anyhow, I thought you'd be interested in these developments. So what we've decided to do on this, I don't think we need an action on it, but what we had done up until this year was to give her $100 for expenses. Carolyn made the arrangements for plane fare, and we'd pay for that. And we've had some complications that turn up every now and then on it, a lot of aggravation bothers, so we decided we'd just give her the cash money and let her be responsible for making her own reservations. And they want to go up by car, say a business. What we done is give them $175 for first class plane fare, round trip, plus $100 that's made $275. And then, you know, they take care of their money. If she wants to get there, it's her business. See what I mean?
I think that's the best trip.
Yeah, it is. It is. It,
parents usually want to go for something like that.
Right. Okay. I'm going to try to get some of these items out of the way that we need your presence on. We're going to take some official action on. Jack?
Okay.
All right. I had a lunch with Bob Oswald and Carl Wiesenberg last week. You know, we took action here. Some time ago, if you remember, we had Wiesenberg before meeting of our board and took some action on filing this going into state court on this property equalization business. And Wiesenberg had went to work and started compiling some facts and figures on it, and then I thought he was about ready to go. I didn't know what had happened, so I called him up here several months ago, and he said the Hurricane Camille and first one thing and another had come along and delayed him. But I talked with Bob in the meantime about whether or not Wiesenberg was interested in going into this thing, and I began to get kind of suspicious that maybe he wasn't. So we had this luncheon down there last week, and he's ready to go now, but he thought that he wanted us to reaffirm our position, I guess. So I told him we'd have a meeting up here on the 17th, and I'd bring it before the committee again, see if he wanted to still get into it. Now, he's got, I think, enough stuff ready to go as far as the disruptions by counties. You know what I mean? Of course, what we propose to do here is to file a suit. At least the first step will be to ask the tax commission itself to fulfill its obligations under the Constitution and institute this thing themselves, which they'll probably fail to do. And of course, we'll make a request of the Attorney General to do the same thing. And when this fails, then we'll proceed to initiate suit here. Now, under the original election that we took, that was voted here to, we were authorized to spend up to $2,000 on court expense. Feeling was, if I remember it, at that time, that we wouldn't go any further than that, and that there wouldn't be any attorney's fee involved in this thing. It'd be simply a matter of court costs. We took it with this understanding, at least my understanding. So you want me to go ahead and tell him to go ahead? It's very apparent that the legislature's not going to move on this right now.
Well, is $2,000 going to be enough to complete the job? What I was getting at, are there any other contributions come from other sources there?
Well, you know, we talked about this, that the possibility of getting some monies from some other sources.
Right.
And, of course, I proceeded to set up a meeting. Well, I talked with Bob Pittman, the MEC. I talked with Johnny Holland with the Power and Light Company. And what's the guy's name with the telephone company, Scott?
Scott.
Yes, Scott. About this whole thing. And everybody agrees that it needs to be done. The MEC is even on record in this respect. But there hasn't been any of them forthcoming in the money. And this is the part that kind of worries me about this thing, is that we get into it, it might cost more than any $2,000 to push it on through.
My concern, Norton, plus that's my concern, plus the fact that Ransom Jones was down there in the CLU meeting a few weeks ago when we were concerned down there about the damn bond issues in Jackson County, so many of them, and this, if we could get the valuation equalized down there, you wouldn't need the bond issue, and he made the statement he was involved in a case whereby that they were going to file a case, in other words, a similar case we're talking about filing here, and so I'm just wondering what parties are involved in this.
Well, Ransom's been in on some of our discussion. He's chomping at the bit to get into this thing, and he wanted me to file Wiesenberg and not him in Oswald to file a suit. He thought Wiesenberg was dragging his feet. So what he's really talking about, he's talking about the suit that we are anticipating filing, and you know, after we talked to Wiesenberg, I thought I ought to go back to him and find out, no, are you really going to go or not? You know what I'm talking about. If you're not, then we're going to probably go another route. Now, Bob suggested, and this had some merit, I got some correspondence from him on that back before I got sick. As a matter of fact, we had a meeting set up. I'm going to get Joel Bass from the Ole Miss Law School to come down, and we're going to talk about the possibility of Joel through subterfuge and sort, where it wouldn't be publicly known that we were behind it. We're going to get some college kids up there themselves to do a research project on this thing, county by county, you know, on the valuation and tax rate and all of that on this. And then after I talked with Bob again, he suggested that maybe we ought to talk to Carl again. So this, it's all the same thing.
Well, I was just wondering if
the same thing. It's, I mean, ransom is not, as far as I know, is not involved in a separate proposed suit.
At least $2,000 would get us through one court, wouldn't it?
I think it'd get us through the state again, though.
Well, that was some Wiesenberg's thinking, too.
Yeah.
But I say at least it would get us through. Then, if necessary, we can take another look at it before we authorize it.
That's about where it would be. I don't know. It's hard to tell. Wiesenberg and some of those are of the opinion that we might get a favorable ruling out of the state court here, and we might not have to go any further. Of course, I agree with you. If we get into the court and we spend our $2,000, we'll darn sure have to take another look at it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Is this out of general or legislative?
What
are you getting?
Well, we ain't got that much in the legislative fund, have we?
That's 3 times.
We got that
much. Reflects the 1,000
slaves. Yeah.
But if we initiate it, I don't think some of the other people come on through.
Yeah.
If we don't get criticism right off from the community.
Yeah.
If we do, they'll probably hold up. Like Mr. Kramer.
Yeah.
We'll see who the utilities are and we'll.
Well, I told each and every one of them that we wouldn't publicize it. If they raised the money, well, that's all we was interested in. If they didn't want it publicized, then we wouldn't publicize it.
Right. Actually, they stand to gain as much as our membership.
More.
Or more.
More.
Because they're talking about money out of their pocket. And they're the people that really carry the tax burden.
They are. Yeah. Yeah. And I don't understand them sitting back like they are. That's right. In the end, in final analysis, we're the ones that's
right.
Picking it up on the water utilities are concerned.
I say pursue.
Well, we want. I don't think any need of taking any more action. We've already took affirmative action once, so I'll just tell them we reviewed it, decided that we ought to proceed with it, and that we'll still think we ought to make an effort to. You find some money elsewhere other than what we're going to do. Now, I think what we agreed to do back at that time, we'd initiate it in the name of the officer of the council, the executive board of the executive committee.
I believe that's right.
In other words, they'd be listed as the plaintiffs in this thing. That's the way it won't be. When it starts zeroing in, it won't be on just Tom Knight and Claude Ramsey.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be some stuff hit the fan when this happens. You can depend on that. Now, on the last board meeting, I've got copies of the minutes here. If I had time, I think it would have been good to have read those minutes just to refresh memory. But if you remember at the last board meeting, we took action on several different situations. One of them involved the insurance situation. And another one involved the railroad situation. Now, in the last session of the legislature, we were able to get a bill through that whereby six railway inspectors would be hired under the direction of the Public Service Commission. And then they also put a tax on the railroads to finance this proposition, whereby the Public Service Commission would be responsible for inspecting railroads. It appears to me that we would need now to see how this is going to come out before we proceed any further. This was, you know, if you remember, we've draft a resolution convention on this matter. But now that the legislature's already acted, it appears to me that this is not necessary. What do you think?
Yeah, certainly we, if this is carried out as it's intended by the legislature there, we ought to give it a time and an opportunity to see if it is going to be effective. And of course we didn't, and then we can take action.
But actually this, you know, when we're talking about we're going to draft a resolution as well, now when this matter comes up in the legislature, it's right in line with what our action was. So I got it in and went to work trying to get the bill through. And of course, that was one of the few pieces of legislation we actually got through that we were interested in. All right, and we'll just let that sit for the time being then and see how it comes out. Now, the other one was, of course, the problem posed by Hurricane Camille and the way the insurance commission itself acted or reacted. We still got that one to deal with. We had legislation introduced over there that would have revised the makeup of the commission itself, where it wouldn't be nominated by the insurance companies. And that bill died, so we still got that one to deal with. I believe this happened after our last board meeting, when the insurance commission granted a 50% increase, the coastal counties a 30% increase, and the next year counties, I believe it was a 12% the rest of the state. And in connection with that, I think I sent you all a copy of the testimony that I presented to the Senate subcommittee that went down and participated in that. Call for regulation of the industry at the national level. I don't think there's any need to take any further action. I just wanted to give you a report on it, where this thing stands. I've come to this conclusion, for whatever it might be worth to the rest of you, that when we start screening candidates for the legislature, I think we need to take a real close look at these birds that's employed or in the insurance business in the legislature. I couldn't help but take note of right during this session that those people in that legislature that are in the insurance business, when you start dealing with legislation affecting insurance of any kind, these people out there represent the insurance companies and not the welfare of the constituents. This, I think, is one of the problems we had with Ted Mallett when getting it working his comp bill through in 68. He's thinking about his insurance firm more than he's thinking about the people.
Yeah. Huh? You got several of this Hines County delegation that's connected with them one way or another.
Right. Yes, sir.
Well, I think Wolf Bill Davis is dead, and he always was talking.
Oh, yeah, I think
hope
he's
so
finished.
Anyway.
Yeah. Well, I tell you, that was something that he, of course, you wouldn't know when I'd ever been down and read the newspapers. And I'm not too sure about what this wasn't deliberately done, because I passed out copies of my testimony to some of the news guys, and they found out what I was going to say. I think they deliberately shut off the TV cameras, and the news reporters all went out to eat about 6 at night.
We're going to do a resolution on this question.
The insurance thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I think we need to. I think we need to keep it before the people for the resolution. Right? Well, didn't we act on that in the last meeting? Wasn't that one of the subjects that we...
I think it was included among the... We acted on several resolutions.
Yeah. Revision of State Insurance Commission, third discussion, and board urged President Rams to work in forthcoming session of the legislature for such. President Rams has stated he had written attorney fly about the possibility of nationwide expense rate on engines related to disasters. No, we didn't get a motion to says Brother D's move the state AFL-CIO work for improvements in overall situation of insurance commission and insurance policy.
Well, look over on that, what we about the resolutions over the convention and see.
Resolutions.
I don't believe there's a motion on that, but I hope there's some relief in this situation.
No, that wasn't listed as one of them.
Now that this session's over, maybe we do need a resolution.
I think we do, right, to present to the convention. You want to offer that as a motion?
I don't.
Draft the resolution, they're calling for, revision and so forth of the insurance commission, is what you want there. You second that, Mr. Brown?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried, so ordered.
I think one thing that's come out in this hearing and statements to the news media during, the questions around the committee, and that is that the commission is, or the legislation providing for the commission is more, for statistical reasons than it is to administer policies of insurance and state Mississippi. Is this right?
Yeah. Basically, yeah.
The act to establish the commission is just about the legislature's statistical information. And this is just an extent.
Well, I attended a hearing over here at the state office building that, you know, Attorney General asked for this year and asked them to hold off on the rate increase till that they would have a rehearing. Assistant Attorney General Coleman handled the thing, of course, the Attorney General himself was there, but Coleman handled it. And that place was full of mostly insurance people. There's one or two members of the legislature come up for it. But I have never seen such an arrogant bunch of people in my life as those insurance people. I mean, they flat laughed at the Attorney General and the case they presented, you know. They think they're too big for anybody to touch is what it amounts to.
Just about all.
Yeah, you know what those dirty son of a guns have done? Of course, you know they went in and settled the claims at a fraction of what they should have settled a lot of them for, and that, on the coast down there. Now a lot of them are refusing to write in any further coverage in the area. And this in itself means that a lot of them can't refinance home building or rebuilding businesses or anything. It's a national disgrace.
They're trying to force the people in and assign risk because like the automobile insurance for these hazardous savings insurance.
Mm-hmm.
Then everybody will take their turn in it. All applications for insurance will be put in the pool and it'll be assigned around.
Mm-hmm.
And then when the catastrophe happens, if it does, why they'll all share in it equally. See, this is a possibility of the whole thing.
Mm-hmm. As I found on that Senate subcommittee, see, you had, Senator Birchbaugh, who chaired the thing, and then you had Spong from Virginia, Gold from Canada, Muskie from Maine, Gravel from Alaska, I believe. That was all of them. But I found a lot of sympathy, even from Dole, the Republican from Kansas, who was looked upon as an ultra-conservative. But in my testimony, in the question and answer session, so forth, I found a lot of sympathy from the part of that subcommittee for federal legislation to regulate this insurance industry, because they've had experience all over the United States of this kind. It's not just in Mississippi, but it's nationwide, and it's not just fire and storm insurance. Automobile insurance and stuff like this as well, see. I think there might as well be something eventually come out of Congress on that. And I guess a resolution of ours, would you want that resolution called for federal regulation?
Well, I can't see why the experience should be retained in state lines. Most of your companies are operating on a national basis anyway.
Right.
Why should we?
The rate be set just within the confines of the state's boundary.
Right. The
And with no regulation whatsoever. See, the only thing we've got is the state insurance agency, and that thing is owned and dominated, you might say, by the industry they're supposed to regulate.
Right.
I mean, I've never seen such a flagrant thing as this over here. They went ahead with their 50% increase after the hearing, anyhow.
Yeah.
Boy, you think, even fellas, they really put old Waterdale Davis through the mill, though, that Senate subcommittee did when he testified.
Y'all are hungry, bastard. Yeah, I'll tell him.
Strike that.
I think in a few times he thought that was next.
I run into Waterdale, huh?
I saw a few excerpts from the news media.
Yeah, boy. I run into Waterdale in the car to the Capitol one day, not long after this happened. He walked on and shook hands with me. Ramsey says, I've been a great admirer of yours. He says, I hope you live a long life.
He's still a politician.
I didn't tell y'all about that, did I? Yeah, that really happened. That's right. He thought, I hope I live to be an old man.
I can't have any sympathy for any public official that was elected by the people and then sell them down the river like he has.
Well,
be dominated by private interests.
I've had a simple question on two or three occasions sought their answer on, and not yet the first time they're given an answer.
Mm-hmm.
Write them a letter.
Yeah.
They reply acknowledging receipt of it without an answer.
Mm-hmm.
Call them on the telephone, and finally, after 3 months now, to get one little interpretation. I got it. It was in favor of the insurance company.
Yeah.
And actually, they put emphasis on language in a brochure of the policy rather than the policy itself.
Well, let's see. We got a couple of items here, I guess, that we need to get. Poor Jack has to get out of here. We're moving on pretty good, though. Tom, you want to tell them about your visit in here the other day from Fayette?
Well, I guess so.
Deacon?
Huh?
Mr. Deacon?
Did you see him? Did he come to see you?
No, he talked to me.
He did?
Yeah.
What did he do by telephone or what?
Well, maybe he might have been down at Alcorn. Mm-hmm. This guy came in here the other day, Alfonso Deal. He's a policeman on leave from the police department, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He's a former member, maybe still a dues-paying member of UAW. I don't know, perhaps he's been a member of state, county, municipal employees. Anyway, he's an acting director of public safety in Fayette, Mississippi. He kind of laughed, told me that he came down to see what he could do about some law enforcement when all the police force was fired or quit or something. He appeared to just talking to a few minutes, maybe a pretty decent old fellow. I don't know. He's black, incident. And of course, he wanted to hit us up for a contribution there. Having a concert here by Leontine Price, his famous Negro singer, entertainer, originally from law on April 26th at the Coliseum. It's a benefit concert, and the proceeds are supposed to go to the building of a cultural recreational center in Fayette. And of course, he wants a contribution. The tickets are $2, $5, $7, and $10. Sent him here. Elmer just put us on the spot here, see. So we thought that before we done anything, I'd take his address and everything. We'd have to talk to the committee about it and see what they want to
capable of doing. He's capable of blackmailing us somewhere down the road if we don't. He's looking for something, not an excuse to hop on us anyhow, you know.
I'm just fixing to ask what kind of cooperation are we getting out of that group of men?
Well, we don't get all that much out of Evers himself. Now, we turn that thing off for a minute. I'm going to just talk a bit more to kick in over $100 or anything. Just be a dope. You know what I mean? We got a little money in that legislative fund that is not actual dues money. You know, from the membership, if anything ever comes up, it's money that has been sent in from elsewhere.
Well, it wouldn't show on the audit either.
It wouldn't show on the audit either. So if whatever we do on this thing, it ought to come out of this kitty. But we got probably would have some white members want to raise hell about it anyhow. Mm-hmm. We can do it that way if you want. And of course, what I thought we'd do is to maybe check around. Maybe some of our black labor leaders might like to go to the thing. Provide them with the tickets. I'd like to hear a woman sing or set.
I love her sing.
Mm-hmm.
I love her sing.
Yes, she's a beautiful voice, huh?
Incidentally, while I was talking about her, he mentioned Alan Johnson, the preacher from Mars. He's pastor in her church, her home church.
Yeah, that's
St. Paul Methodist.
Well, we might want to buy some tickets and invite him.
Let him give him some tickets. That'd be a good way to do that, huh?
Matter of fact, she's the one that really built that new church. Her money and her doing,
yeah.
Her work is really
brought in the
yeah. So if you want to, we'll handle it that way.
I'd offer a motion that
we buy $100 worth of tickets out of the legislature. Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. All right. resolutions and constitutional changes. Mr. Knight has been working on a number of resolutions and some constitutional changes. Now, if you remember, one of our board meetings some time ago, I think, as a matter of fact, this happened at the board meeting right after our convention. L.D. Clark come up with a motion was passed that I appoint a committee to review our Constitution. And, of course, we've appointed such a committee, which hasn't done too much up until recently. Fits you out here with NPI, the Carpenters Group, as chairman of the thing. And we're going to have to give him a couple more guys, looks like, to replace the original committee to work with him. But anyhow, what he's doing, is, along with Tom's help, is reviewing the Constitution and some areas that we feel like it ought to be improved upon. And if this meets your approval, we'll handle that this way instead of having to put a lot of work here with constitutional changes submitted, we'll say, by the executive board. Of course, this is kind of an ad hoc committee, really, just to study this thing. So what I thought we'd probably do is to, you know, let Fitch, you and a couple other guys review this thing, put them on the Constitution Committee at the convention, and we appoint the committee and let them go through this Constitution at the convention and bring their report out and their recommendations for changes rather than drafting a lengthy resolution, which has to be sent out, 35 days prior to the convention. In other words, just let the committee bring this thing out. You see what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
How do y'all like to handle?
I think that would be the simplest way to
handle it. It'll take a lot of work out of this office.
The only other way you can do it other than going the long route.
Then that's the only way. See, the committee itself can bring a whole change out. Now, we've got one constitutional amendments have been sent in by the Columbus Central Labor Council. But I imagine if it's passed, we'll put old L.D. Clark in audit. That resolution, of course, will have to be sent out to, you know, being submitted by a central body. Wayman Goodman, I think, has offered it. But what he's doing is proposing to set the structure of the executive board up, whereby each central body would be allowed X number of members, I mean, you know, the area on the board, according to the affiliated membership. As it stands now, based upon the formula that he's proposing in that resolution, the Meridian Central Body wouldn't be allowed with one member of the board because they have a low percent of the people over there affiliated. You see, if you're a member and this stuff come up, I told Clark that this was a problem. You get all them local affiliated over, there'd be no problem getting them another board member. But you can't justify all them board members over there with no more affiliation over there. Be interested to see how what this one comes up with. Of course, it would, if it's passed, it would actually enlarge the executive board by how many, Tom?
21 people instead of the 17. Based on the present affiliation.
We got copies of them. Let's see if we can get there. Well, here's a copy of them.
Well, this is.
You got enough copies for all of them?
This is his right here.
Jack's?
This was
Oh.
I mean, that was Jack's.
That's the resolution. But anyhow, what the thing is, you can see as the affiliation in the area would increase, go from 3,001 board member, 3,052. In other words, you'd get a...
He's not changing vice presidents.
Wouldn't change the vice presidents at all. Just the board. He's thinking, they're thinking over there, I understand it is, that this would be an incentive to get people affiliated. You know what I mean? And of course, the additional affiliates would pay for the additional board members. I can see some problems with this thing. What we'd probably have to do is change the CLU district thing and break the state down in districts because some places we don't have CLU districts. You know what I mean? I think we'd have to work out something and draw up our own district. It would be separate from the CLU district. But the thing does have a certain amount of merit. And another thing that we think this would do, and the comment I've been talking about a little bit, is that maybe it would make some of these locals start paying on their full membership. That's another problem we have in addition to the affiliation thing, is we got several locals that's fudging on us, you know what I mean? Not paying on their full membership. Of course, we don't have to act on this, the board on this, being submitted by the Columbus Central Labor Union. Under the Constitution, we're mandated to mail this one out, you see. I thought you'd be interested. So if it's all right with you fellas, I don't think it's necessary to act on this thing because the board has already instructed me to set up this committee to study the Constitution. We'll just go ahead and when we appoint the Constitution Committee, we'll include on it the guys that's working on this. Think it's necessary to take any action on it, you want
to? I'm sure it is.
Think so, Ronnie?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, we'll just let it lay like it is. Now, while we on this convention thing, we thought we ought to talk to you a little bit about the program. Find out whether or not you thought we ought to try to have something down there. Maybe doing one night of the affair or entertainment or what have you. So Tom picked up a copy of the menu down at the Edgewater Gulch. stuff, but tight spread that they can put on for something like this, and as you can see, it's rather expensive. That seafood jamboree thing there at
the bottom
of the restaurant, it'd be $7.25.
Yeah, it's about 6, right? All total.
Seafood jamboree.
You
would run you. How much did we say it would run?
$7.25 at bottom of the
seafood. And of course, the state council is not in a position to finance something like that. I think Tom checked with the majority of the committee on when we set this registration fee. We've been setting it at 3, and because of the increased cost and everything, it's our feeling maybe we ought to go up to $4. So that's the call that's being prepared to send out now, and that we set the registration fee at $4. But if we decide to put something on down there, then we'll probably have to sell tickets to it. And the question is whether people would want to kick in $7 for tickets. And
frankly, I think they'd much prefer to, since they would have been in session all the entire time, I think they'd much prefer to go on out and eat wherever they wanted to. You know, do whatever they wanted to do.
You might include this as a question in your call and ask for an immediate response.
If we don't get any quicker answers on it than we do anything else, we wouldn't know we got.
Tom, you reckon we could, I wonder how long it'd take to prepare for something. We might pull the convention the first day.
Yeah, I've been trying now.
We might pull the convention on the first day and find out if they wanted us to make some kind of arrangements.
I would have to find out my hotel if we
see how much notice they got
on Monday, if they can, you know, have it ready Tuesday night then, or something like that. But I doubt it. I doubt if they do it on that short notice. We can see.
Tom, I kind of think they would, because, you know, since this Sam or Eric and down there, since Camille, they're a little bit short on business.
Yeah.
So I suspect they would do it.
They might do it.
They want, the only other thing to do is through the mail. As Carolyn said, a response sometime.
I do good to get the cup tags. That's on the floor. Several of them won't have to go do it from.
Yeah, we got a couple of three local unions, just like pulling our teeth on that captain. We spend as much money as we get out of them on telephone calls and letters on them.
Right. Coffee. That's nice.
Coffee. Yeah, CWA local. Yeah, it's an annual. It's a monthly or a quarterly.
Get James Jackson on.
Yeah, that's what we'll have to do is get James. Man, if we have everybody out of that thing like ACWA, well, this be a pleasure, wouldn't it? That's something you don't have to worry about. See, this joint board handles the per capita for the whole works. You know what I mean? They handle it all through there. You don't ever have to worry about those local. And we got one down at Tylertown that's not a member of the joint board, and we have problems with that one ever. Old James, he really handles that thing for the rest of it. All right, well, what we'll do then, if it's all right with you fellas, we'll, Tom can call the hotel and see what possibilities are here, and if there is a possibility that they can put this thing on Tuesday night after we say notify them by noon Monday, then we'll go ahead that way. But I don't see how in the world we can possibly finance this thing. It'll have to be done by ticket sales. And of course, if we do put it on, and I think probably need to think about a banquet speaker.
You can't do that on a Monday morning.
That poses a problem. It really does. Might put Dan Powell on.
I'm
Don't let them know it. That'll answer the question.
While we're talking about the resolutions, I think we, at the board meeting, we discussed this resolution calling for the voluntary contribution for the legislative fund. I've whacked out a resolution. Yeah, you think we ought to read it for Jack and Robbie, see what they think about it?
Yeah, read it to them.
This is, you recall in 1960, if anybody had asked me, I'd have swore it in 62, but I checked the convention proceeding in 1960 when we established this legislative fund. and this is just a roughed out thing. Whereas the 1960 convention of the Mississippi AFL-CIO established a special legislative fund, whereas the initial contribution was provided by the various local unions in the amount of $1 per member, whereas the forthright action of the 1960 convention and the response cooperation of the local unions contributed greatly to the progress made in the 60s, and whereas the anti-labor forces of Mississippi continue their efforts in the political arena and legislative halls against working men and women, whereas unlimited funds are readily available to these forces who have made millions of dollars at the expense of the working people, whereas if organized labor is to continue to fight and be effective in the 1970 legislative election, financial resources are an absolute necessity. Therefore, be it resolved that the 5th Biennial Convention of the Mississippi AFL-CIO reaffirm its support of this special fund and instruct the officers to continue same. Be it further resolved that each local union be called upon to make a contribution to this fund of at least $1 per member in 1970 and 1971. Be it finally resolved that copies of this resolution be mailed to all locals and request their prompt response. Now, there's a question I want to ask, Chair. You notice there, I put in 1970 and 1971. There's a question as to whether or not we ought to hit them for 2 years. Of course, we can stand it all we can get, but do we want to do that?
Actually, you're talking about the last 6 months or seven. Last 5 months or seven.
And of course, if it's federal.
Early in 71.
If the federal courts approve this primary election law, of course, you know, there won't be an election until October 1971. This would give more time as far as that goes.
We do at least need the contribution in the first 6 months.
Yeah.
In order to wait.
So we don't know how much we spend.
Right. Yeah.
I thought in addition to this resolution, I'd also get out of an appeal to the International Union to also be up in this area. And maybe out of the AFL-CIO. And we are in the process of trying to set up some kind of a committee of state council officers to probably go see media, maybe meet with the executive council itself about this overall problem, affiliation, and the fact that most of the program adopted by the AFL-CIO is being dumped in the lap of the state council for implementation, and we're going to have some help. And that means money. You know what I'm talking about? That's in the process also. But I'm in agreement that we need to pass this resolution or one along this line and ask our locals to help also.
I don't think request for two contributions would eliminate any contribution.
What
if they're
going
to make one, they'd make one anyway.
What do you
and
think? You're under this, be it further resolved, that we should explain a time period here? If we're going to, you know, ask for a contribution then 7 and 7.
You could rephrase that thing a little bit and say, ask them to make a contribution to this special legislative fund, either the fall of 1970 or the early spring of 1971. You could rephrase that a little bit, where you, which I can talk about a buck a member, I think, and if we get a buck a member out of one at one time, I think we'll be lucky.
You won't get it, of course, out of both times, as far as that's concerned, but then, what I'm thinking, if you come in here asking for a contribution letter for this year, then what elections are you referring to so we can justify for, for use in 71?
Right. We're shooting at the 71 election. That's
right.
What we're talking about.
So, I would think.
He's gone.
Are we talking about the congressional election?
No, we're talking about the state legislature. You see, one whereas, if organized labor's continued to fight and be effective in the 1971 legislative election, financial resources are an absolute necessity.
This indirectly will have a bearing on the congressional situation to this effect. It'll be mandatory that the Mississippi legislature reapportion itself. It won't be mandatory that it reapportion itself either, but I mean, it will be subject to reapportion. And if they don't do it, then we'll probably have to ask the courts to, which still have this thing, accept the reapportion of the legislature prior to the next session. This in itself then will have a bearing on redistricting the congressional districts. Congressional districts will be up for redistricting after the census also, And of course, it depends on whether or not we lose the congressman as to whether they have to redraw our congressional district line. Chances are we won't this time, as I understand it. But that is also in the picture. If we lose a congressman, then the makeup of the legislature will decide how your congressional lines are going to be drawn. See, what I'm trying to say is that the legislature itself, I mean, even though we're just talking about the legislature, it does have a bearing on the congressional situation. Here's what we've got to do, Jim. And it's going to take some money. We have got to have money enough to go into some of these key counties, find a candidate, finance his campaign pretty well ourselves, to knock some of these mossbacks out that's giving us trouble. And I don't think that we can sit by when they organize the legislature at this next election and the speaker's race. I'm convinced myself that we have got to try to do something about getting a favorable speaker in that house, because all of our problems in this last session in final analysis be traced back to the speaker who appoints all the committees. A problem is still with the stack committees in the House of Representatives. I got 11:30. So that's what we're talking about, is money to elect the legislature. See?
Well, I still say that I don't think the request for each year would cost us any money unless they shelve it and wait until the general election.
Probably you'd have to first send out one with copies of this thing, make the appeal, and if you see, you'd probably have spotted up. I think maybe we might reword this a little bit and add another sentence here and point out that this can be done in late 70 or early 71 or something of this effect.
Well, let's talk about something else. Is that pretty well agreed on this? Let's get on to something else we want to get before Jack leaves. I got this matter of affiliation down here, but I think we can just report to you that the situation is improving, that we've picked up a number of new locals and the promise of several more in sometime in the near future. We haven't lost chemical workers. We've been in pretty good shape now. But we still going to have a continuation of the two subsidies we're getting in here if we continue doing the job and if we're to get any salary increases. So I wrote Stan Smith to this effect already. Let's talk about the College Board. I passed out to you gentlemen a copy of the letter that Mr. Roberts mailed out to the members of the College Board. This is something that I'm very much concerned about myself because I've got two kids going over to Mississippi State now. My two oldest sons, well, my oldest son and the third son are both over there. Of course, I'm not looking at this just from my own personal point of view, but I'm very concerned about this College Board and Mr. Roberts in particular with his philosophy and attitude. And I'm not trying to defend the students' rights to hear Mr. Evers altogether. I do think that we have to be concerned over the fact that we have a gentleman like this heading up the Board of Institutions of Higher Learning whose attitude is that he don't think that the kids ought to hear any speakers by himself. That includes us. I think you all know that for a long time that Mr. McCain down at Mississippi Southern continually vetoed my appearance on the campus. You know what I'm talking about. So if this thing can be carried to its full length as Mr. Roberts advocates, it means that we'd be excluded from the campus as well as anybody else.
Well, doesn't this kill or couldn't this kill our program of economic education?
Certainly could.
Probably didn't have it in mind, but this letter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is, Wayne. We wouldn't be allowed to hold a school up there.
Right. Right.
Seems to me that Dr. Martin, Charles Sullivan, and several people ought to be concerned with the text of that letter.
Of course, that letter,
Charlie knows about it.
I'm sure he does. You, that's a lulu of a letter, ain't it?
Well, how long a term are those boards appointed?
12.
Board?
12 years. He's got till 72. And he says he's not going to resign. That was a statement he made on that he was quoted as making on the radio this week. You know, all kinds of student groups have been after him. You know, they've been writing him and complaining to everybody in the state. He says he has no intention of resigning. He's going to serve his 12 years. See, they had legislation here to cut that to 6. That all fell through.
Well, certainly I think that should be cut. 12 years appointment wouldn't do a deal like that. And you're stuck with a guy like that on the board. Well, it's just too long.
Well, the first thing old Barnett done when he was governor, make old Robert, put old Roberts on that board.
Are you thinking in terms of a news release or a resolution for convention?
No, I'm thinking about probably a statement coming out of this meeting, because I thought I'd meet your approval and I'd probably work up a statement about our meeting and some of the actions that we took and include in that whatever action you think we ought to take pertaining to the College Board, not just get at the College Board. We might express our concern over the recent action of the State College Board and the fact that and that we've studied the situation. We've stuff in several news stories. I've got a whole file on it in my office in there. Bill Miner wrote a column in the Picayune, Eyes on Mississippi. You get it, I'm sure. Picayune down your way.
Yeah.
Brother White is red. I've got that. And then Bob Boyd, the Dallas Democrat Times, did a story that was front page in that story and where he quoted the entire text of the letter. So the letter has been aired out in the press. You know what I'm talking about. And then, of course, you saw in this morning's paper where they come out with a statement supporting M. Roberts' position. And I think what we need to do is express our concern over the fact that the State College Board is upholding this man. As we do it, he's infringing upon academic freedom. You know what I'm talking about. And we ought to at least go on record, I think, in opposition to what the present board is doing. And just totally something like this is what I had in mind. You know what I'm talking about.
Of course, academic freedom is kind of a wide subject to get into the press, isn't it?
It really is.
If we could deal with it and deal specifically with our interest in having speakers on campus, and especially with the Council of Economic Education, just getting on the way with planned institutes already, maybe this would be the first approach.
Well, if you guys want to take some kind of action before anything is said or done, I don't know when I'd be able to get to this. I'm meeting with them. To be honest in this, I think I've got a speaking engagement in the morning with the AUPSC, Association of College Professionals.
If you're going to get a motion, you're going to have to go. We need to take that to go now. If you're going to do anything, because I got to go.
So what I say, if y'all think we need to take some action in this area, when I can get to it, I'll draft it. And I can call you on the telephone and we'll get with you for anything.
This, you know, this, I can see some avenues in real controversy if we get into, you know, the blanket statement.
Yeah.
I think whatever we say should be pretty well pointed to our interests.
Right. Yeah, we don't want to get this thing colored black too much. So if that meets approval of both of you, all right, then we'll try to handle it in that fashion. I don't think we got anything else that really needs action. I had two or three other things down here that time would have permitted that I'd like to review with you. For instance, convention speakers, we're still working on that. And you'll be interested in knowing that I have been able to get Byard Ruskin to agree to come down and address the convention. Byard Ruskin, he's the director of the A. Philip Randolph Institute. He received a standing ovation at the AFL-CIO convention. And he's saying a few things that needs to be said. With the consumption of black and whites, I don't know how much y'all have been keeping up with what this guy's been saying, but he's been laying it on the line as far as these black extremists are concerned. You know what I'm talking about? I thought it'd be an appropriate time to get somebody like this in here. You know what I'm talking about. I've wrote Senator Muskie, I haven't heard from him. I've wrote Elaine Kirkland, I haven't heard from him. I'm writing letters right now, the first one and another, and we'll continue to do so in the next week or so.
Really?
To see how many, I don't know just where we are yet. Still following through on our last meeting. Well,
hey,
hate to run.
I know you gotta go. I think we pretty well got to go to work on the audit. We've got to do this for long. And the same thing on the Constitution Committee. We're working on that now. Jack, we appreciate you coming over.
Sorry, I have to run.
We're gonna have Kentucky Fried Chicken?
Some kind of fried chicken.
You missing it?
Well, I guess that pretty well takes care of what we need any action on.
Y'all decide to issue a statement on this thing?
Yeah, on the,
Mr. Roberts?
On the College Board's, action. Of course, as Jack points out, what we wanna do on this thing is to, point out how this policy might affect some of the programs that we're interested in implementing on the colleges and whatever. You know what I mean? Where it won't be just a blanket, castigation of the board itself, you know what I mean? Now, Tom, have we got anything else we need to talk about, Rodney?
Let's see.
We don't have a quorum now, we can't take any more action.
Yeah, something I meant to give on.
You didn't talk about this, may come up in the, constitutional changes you're working out with Fitchy. Have you talked to him about this mandatory executive board changing that board meeting?
No.
About what?
No, I hadn't mentioned.
About the mandatory executive.
Oh, yeah, that's something we.
You certainly wanna get that out if you're gonna enlarge your board to 22.
Yeah, Robbie, that's something that, I guess we should've got into here with Jack. Of course, we run out of time, but under our present, under the Constitution now, we are mandated to call, what is it, how many board meetings?
Two.
Two a year. And, we, don't feel that this, in other words, we had to go to the expense of calling a board meeting last December just because of that, constitutional requirement when we could have got by without one. You know what I mean? So we think that maybe that thing ought to be revised. In other words, be mandatory for one a year. And then, special meetings be called upon.
Section need.
Yeah, section.
Special meeting, executive board may be called by the executive committee at its discretion.
That's where it ought to be.
They committee rules anyway, doesn't it?
Yeah. So,
Especially if you don't enlarge the board, it's much more expensive.
You're doggone right, if we get into that, that's right.
Well, I know.
Yeah, of course, we don't know what's gonna happen on that enlarge the board. I frankly doubt it'll pass, but, anyhow, we have, it cost us close to $1,000 when you get through with it to have a doggone board meeting. And that's a lot of money.
Especially if you don't need it.
You don't need to have one, but under the Constitution, we're mandated to have at least two a year, you know.
And at least three committee meetings.
Well, ain't no problem with committees. Well, we usually have more than that many meetings of the committee. But it ain't all that expensive to have a meeting of the executive committee, you know what I mean. Well, you got lunch ready?
I knew there was something else about this Constitution that needed to talk about the other day.
You might want it to reflect in the minutes of this committee meeting. I don't know if necessary or not to say it. That the officers ratified a new contract with officers.
Yeah, well, I had that, on my list, but we're running out of time. Jack had to leave.
You let it show in the minutes.
We better not say anything about the concessions made, the cost of the thing.
Hey, shoot.
Yeah, make a note there. Ratify new contract.
I'm gonna put to give you this original back, but don't. I got witnesses now.
Well, can we adjourn this meeting? Gonna have to, we ain't got a quorum. ask you all to stand and ask Brother Schaefer to open me with a word of prayer.
God, our Heavenly Father, as we approach thy throne of grace, we're thankful for all the blessings of life. We're thankful that we're privileged to assemble here as people representing free labor to further the purposes for which we strive. We pray, Father, at this time that we might know that we are thy making, that we are subject to thy leading, that we will only seek thy leading. So we come praying that we might be led by thy Holy Spirit as we deliberate upon things which will focus this organization for the next 2 years. We pray that we might be conscious of this, Father, and that we might be guided in a way that would please thee. Forgive us for all the times that we fail to abide by the dictates of our heart when we feel that thou hast led us. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, let me welcome all of you to the executive board meeting. And before we proceed with any business, I want to introduce two new board members that some of you might not have met yet, Brother Grantham and the folks at the far corner. Would you stand up and take a bow? And while you're standing, we'll ask Brother Starnes, if he would, to give you the obligation.
That was sneaky, wasn't it?
Well, each of you raise your right hand and use your name where I use my name. I, Bob Starr, do hereby promise to do thy promise to faithfully perform the duties of the office, to which I have been elected, to the best of my ability. And to the benefit and honor, of the Mississippi AFL-CIO, and in the event of my resignation, or removal from office, or at the expiration of my term, I promise to deliver to my successor, all property and my possession belonging to this council. I further promise to protect and defend the American Federation of Labor and Congress of Industrial Organizations. During my term of office. Thank you. Congratulations. Be seated.
Congratulations to both of you. Now, it's customary for new board members to make a speech, so you now will be afforded that opportunity. Who wants to go first? We also want to welcome Betty Sue Riley to our board meeting, the statewide director. Maybe some of you haven't met Betty yet or know who she is. That's her in the light blue dress there in the middle. Betty, would you like to make a speech?
I'm going
to
be like
their
mom.
Okay, we're glad to have all of you. After taking over, since we've got, I think, two board members not yet present, and I hope that they will arrive before we get too far along, but since we have a lot of work to do, I thought we ought to try to get started as soon as we can. Now, we have the minutes of the last executive committee meeting of April 17, 1970, and of the last executive board meeting December 5, 1969. Now, copies of these minutes have all been mailed out to you. We won't beg you to read them unless you want them read, but we would like to seek the approval of them. And would you like to have them read, or are you going to go on your past memory on what the ones you received? I'll leave it up to you.
I'm sure I
refresh your memory on it?
Please.
Well, maybe ought to just let Brother Nice read them.
It's too long.
You want to kind of summarize them for me? That's the last board meeting in December. And the last day for the meeting.
Okay.
call a meeting to order at 10 a.m. in the room and ask Vice President Edwards to give an indication. President Ramsey stated he hopes the meeting would be short so that after the lunch, board members would be able to visit the new office building at 826 Northwest Street. He then discussed details of purchasing the property and explained that the interest-free loan from the AFL-CIO would be repaid slightly over 8 years for monthly installments of $300. He further explained the renovation of the building and other expenses had run about $1,000, more than had been estimated, which had to be paid from the general fund. L.D. Clark stated he felt it was a big step forward for organized labor with Mississippi and should have been done long ago. Brother Clark moved to action of the executive committee in connection with the purchase and handling of the new building be approved. Brother Edwards seconded the motion carried. Brother D. stated he had visited the office the day before and was well pleased with it. He also expressed appreciation to the committee and staff for the effort. President Ramsey mentioned that due to the high cost of mailing, all board members would be asked to take car tags back to their respective areas and distribute to various locals. Due to the expulsion of the chemical workers in the National Union and AFL-CIO, the next matter discussed was replacing board member Paul Collins, member of Local 800 Chemical Workers Greenwood. President Ramsey stated he felt someone to replace Collins should come from the Delta area and mentioned E.M. Grantham Greenwood, CLU president, steel worker, J.O. Hitchcock, North Delta. Central Body President Machinist. The matter was thoroughly discussed. Brother Jackson moved that E.M. Grantham be nominated for the board. Brother D. seconded. Brother Grantham was elected by acclamation. President Ramsey discussed the shop steward training program, which were held in 69, with the possibility of follow-up sessions in 70. Due to the legislative meeting in January and the convention in July, it was thought the next fall would be the best time to hold it. However, since the local and Meridian area did not participate in another workshop, Ramsey discussed the need of holding a program in Meridian the early part of 70. He asked Brother Clark to check with the central body and advise him the best time to hold it. Our United States Coke Director was asked to give a report on the carbon file situation. He reported the National AFL-CIO Coke Office was in favor of setting a statewide carbon file system in the state AFL-CIO office due to many problems involved with central body. However, this would involve a great deal of money and the national office would have subsidized Mississippi setup. Well, I stated this would be discussed further at the COPE conference in January. He would be able to report more after that date. I then asked the board to establish policy for state council officers regarding pay for vacation time not taken. He discussed many problems involving himself, President Ramsey this year, and the fact that they had not been able to take their full vacation time. The board discussed the matter thoroughly, stating the vacation should be taken if at all possible. Brother McDaniel moved that it would be the policy of the state AFL-CIO for officers to receive pay for any vacation time not taken at the end of each fiscal year. Motion seconded and carried. Except in the convention, the next topic of discussion, suggested speakers of the convention were Lieutenant Governor Sullivan, Senator Theodore Smith, other friends in the legislature, AFL-CIO Secretary Treasurer Kirkland, State Central Body Coordinator Stanton Smith, Walter Holmes, Red Cross, Joe Burns, CWA, Paul Jennings, IUE. It was further suggested that a letter be written to all international unions inviting representatives of their staff to attend the convention. President Ramsey asked the board to submit any other names of persons they thought should be invited to speak to the convention. Resolution for the convention were then discussed. First subject was a revision of the JP court system. All other public officials on a fee basis. Brother Edwards moved the resolution be drafted. Mailed the board members and then presented resolution committee convention. Motion carried. Second carried. Division of the State Insurance Commission was thoroughly discussed and the board urged President Ramsey to work the forthcoming session of the legislature for such. President Ramsey stated he had written attorney Henry Fly about the possibility of nationwide experience rate on insurance related to disaster. Brother D. moved that the state AFL-CIO works for improvements in the overall situation of the insurance commission and insurance policy. Motion seconded and carried. Secretary Treasurer and I discussed the need of presenting a resolution convention establishing a voluntary donation of $1 per member for political education fund. This fund will be used to help elect a friendly legislature in 71. It stated we would need a minimum of $50,000 that local unions could make contributions and trade the money to this fund. Brother D. said the move that said resolution be presented to the forthcoming convention, establishing a
special fund, he spent 71 legislative races with an amount of $1 per member collected in 7. Motion second and carried. President Lambert told the board to take action for legislation favoring lowering the voting age to 18. Several board members felt this matter had already been acted on. However, Brother Needed moved that the state AFL-CIO won record in support of legislation lowering the voting age to 18. Motion second and carried. Meeting was set for lunch 12 to 1 p.m. President Lambert stated another matter needing attention was deteriorating railroad lines and tracks. Reported in several October issues of commercial appeal. He mentioned the disaster in Laurel, Glendora, Mississippi as recent examples, and state legislation was badly needed to force the railroad to maintain safe tracks. After discussion, Brother Jackson moved to present resolution on the matter of the convention. Motion second and carried. REA other suggested resolution subjects. REA co-ops program of progress, change in precinct county convention. Endorsing AFL-CIO position on presidential election system. Change in constitution regarding $8 per day meal allowance. Equal distribution of board members by areas. President Ram discussed the Jackson City employee situation and recent developments. He also urged all board members who possibly could to attend the forthcoming meeting of the Council on Economic Education. GE strike situation was then presented for general discussion. AFL-CIO Regional Director R.W. Starr gave a brief, comprehensive report on the background of the strike. He stated it was a fight of every union in the AFL-CIO, and 13 unions were involved in the strike, 10 affiliated with the AFL-CIO. Starr stated there were 155 workers involved in the strike. He reported the full staff of AFL-CIO was being used to back and help these strikers. Director Starr discussed the nation. A statewide meeting to be held in Jackson for all local union leadership December 15th, 6 to 9 at IUE Hall. The representative in Washington office of AFL-CIO will be present to discuss support of GE strike and boycott of GE product. John suggested contribution strike fund be mailed to Lane Kirkland's office in Washington. President Rounders suggested, however, since two locals in Mississippi were involved in the strike, that money be contributed directly to these two locals. Brother Dunlap reported URW Local 303 Jackson and furnished the use of their hall, Southwest Street Utilities, and etc. plus $1 per member to the two locals on strike. Brother McDaniel reported IUE workers and Vickers voted to contribute $2.50 per week to the strike, but the company was deducted from payroll. Brother Ramsey named Xavier committed to serve as GE strike committee along with members of the executive board who live in Jackson. The state of the census was so near to Christmas, he felt state AFL-CIO should make a contribution to these two local unions. Brother Dunlap moved to contribute $300 to IBEW over 1435-1493 strike fund. Motion second and carried. Brother Jackson moved President Ramsey write to the governor concerning the fact no labor representatives were on the committee established to advise the governor on state government or Harrington Familial Committee. Motion second and carried. There being no further business, meeting adjourned 2 p.m. Members visited the office.
We have any corrections, any discussion on the minutes? Any coordinating?
I make a motion the minutes be received and adopted with necessary corrections, if there be any.
Second. Not all in favor of approving the minutes, signify to say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Order. We also have the minutes of the executive committee meeting of April 17th. Would you like those read also?
Meeting was called to order 10:15 a.m. and President Ramsey stated he thought the meeting would be concluded before noon. Before Vice President Schaefer would have to leave. First item of business was the constitutional amendment. He voted on June 2nd, 1970. The proposed amendment would allow the governor 15 days instead of 5 to sign a veto bill after the legislature adjourned. It was viewed as a good amendment by President Ramsey since it would allow more time for study bills passed in closing days of the session. Vice President Shaver moved that we support the constitutional amendment. Vice President Robbins seconded the motion carried. President Ramsey explained that in the past, the state AFL-CIO supported efforts the Economic Council and the Mississippi Council on Economic Education. This year, the two organizations have merged their fundraising campaigns, and the committee were asked for action on this year's contribution. The matter was thoroughly discussed. The committee members felt this money was well spent. Vice President Schaefer moved the state AFL-CIO contribute $500 to the Mississippi Council on Economic Education. Vice President Robbins seconded the motion. President Ramsey reported that he planned to contact Mr. Ben Lampton, head of the fundraising campaign, to see about getting some publicity on organized labor's contribution. The next matter considered was a court suit on property equalization to be filed by Attorney Carl Wiesenberg. President Ramsey stated that Wiesenberg was ready to file the suit, but he wanted the committee to reaffirm its support. The situation was discussed, and it was the feeling of the executive committee that the council should go ahead with plans to file the suit, giving the figure of $2,000 in mind as a total amount that could be spent on the suit. Wiesenberg felt this would be sufficient to get through state court, and the business community would be asked to help with finance. President Ramsey discussed action on the last executive board meeting, which urged him to work with legislature to reform insurance commission and safety on the railroad. He stated the legislature had acted on railroad situation, and the committee felt the railroad should be given time to take the necessary corrective action. However, the need to reform the insurance commission was still evident. The committee proposed that a resolution be introduced to convention on this subject. President Ramsey stated that he felt future candidates for legislation should be carefully screened on their connections with the insurance industry. He stated that members of the legislature employed by insurance company generally represented these companies rather than the people. Vice President Schaefer moved that a resolution be presented before the coming convention of the AFL-CIO, state AFL-CIO, calling for a revision of the insurance commission and for federal regulation. Robbins seconded motion. Carried. Secretary Treasurer and I report on his recent visit to Mr. Alfonso Deal, Public Safety Commissioner in Fayette, Mississippi. He asked the state AFL-CIO for a contribution on purchase of tickets to Leontine Price concert to be held in Jackson April 26, 7. Proceeds to go to Cultural Center at Fayette. It was a feeling executive committee that a small contribution should be made in order to ensure continued goodwill with the Negro community. Vice President Schaefer moved to buy $100 worth of tickets to the concert distributed to Negro Union members. These contributions be made from the legislative fund. Vice President Robbins seconded. Motion carried. Resolution constitutional change to be presented at the forthcoming convention were discussed. Secretary Knight reported that the only constitutional change so far that had to be mailed to the local union was the one from the Columbus Central Body. Other possible changes would come from the Constitution and Bylaws Committee appointed the convention. The committee discussed holding a see-through jamboree at the convention. Knight reported the price ranged from $6 to $7 per person. President Ramsey stated the council could not afford to pick up this call. It would have to be paid for by the delegates. Some members felt the delegates would prefer to go their individual ways at the convention. However, the committee asked Secretary Treasurer Knight to check with the hotel, see if they could prepare a seafood jamboree on Tuesday night if they were notified by noon on Monday. President Ramsey stated he would put it to a vote of the delegates the first thing on Monday morning, and they could make the final decision. Knight read his drafted resolution on the need of special legislative funds of 71 to help elect members of the legislature. The resolution called for $1 per member, emphasized the importance of replacing several members of the present legislature. Future progress was to be made. Another matter considered by the committee was the current controversy centering around Mr. M. Roberts, chairman of the State College Board. The committee reviewed the situation in detail and concluded that President Ramsey should release a statement to the news media on the subject along with a report of the committee's for the constitutional amendment. No further business. The meeting adjourned at 12 noon.
Have a discussion on the executive committee meeting of April 17th. We have a motion to approve.
Second motion.
Any discussion? Not all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, motion carried. So ordered. A couple of things, yes, that I want to touch on that was mentioned in those minutes. Number one, since we had that meeting, it's become very apparent that it would be impossible to make arrangements for a banquet or a jamboree this late date, so that's out. The other thing is that we need to establish something here. I might order this out of order of the convention on setting the restoration fee high enough to pick up the tab for a banquet. Now, the $4 restoration fee that we're charging this year is $1 more than it's been in the past, and this only pays a small portion of convention costs. Now, I understand that most state councils are setting their restoration fee somewhere around $10 to $12, and included in that would be the cost of a fee or banquet. Would you like to take this up at the after the convention now, or let the convention vote on it? We definitely need to do something in this area.
I got a question asking you, Mr. Charles.
What do you say?
I got a question asking
you. All right.
I think maybe the delegate might put that thing in, and then it might hurt their being represented at the state labor council meetings. I mean, when they get back to the local union, they may frown on that. The hell, anything, you go down and have a big blowout.
Well, it's of course this is one of the risks that you incur when you are elected to represent people. You know what I'm talking about. If you don't assume that obligation,
I know that. What I'm talking about is this, as far as the state, I mean, labor council.
Well, we can. What I had thought about doing was just simply fixing up a ballot. And polling the delegates, not putting them on record or anything, but just finding out how they feel. You know, the last time when we had the convention in Jackson, if you remember, we had the legislature invited out. The council picked up the cost on the meal for the legislature, and the delegates then bought tickets themselves, which paid for their meal. Now, we can set it up like that if you want to in the future. But our financial condition just won't permit us to pick up the tab on a banquet for the convention.
I think they could manage to swindle their expense account and get the meal paid for it better than they could get the $10 registration fee out of their local union.
Well, that's probably true. What you want to consider this matter and just leave it late like it is?
I think the committee should make recommendations to the convention one way or the other.
But you want the new board to do this?
I think that's our job here, to bring before the convention, make a recommendation of whether we do or don't, and decide here. And if we decide we need it here, then I think we should make the recommendation to the committee and let them either endorse it or turn it down.
To the convention?
To the convention, yeah.
Okay, anybody else?
Yes, I just wanted to say it. Suppose everybody else local is like ours, capital tax just keep going up and up, and it's hard to get the union dues up. But as far as the registration fee, I believe it'd be easier to go up on the registration fee than I do on the expense account.
I mean,
on the local, I assume that most locals send the registration fee in advance.
Yeah, most of them.
And that seems, you know, it keeps it somewhat apart in the expense account.
Yeah.
And I go to several conventions a year, and this is about the lowest registration fees that I know of anywhere.
Southern State Friendship Conference, which I just left coming down here,
$18. They look different there. What does that include? Anybody else want to Well, I guess our local probably operates different from most local. The registration fee would be a lot better for delegates, because when we send a delegate off, we give them some money. And such as buying that ticket, it has to come out of that money, see? But when you have this fee, it comes out of the expense. Either way, it wouldn't be too much hardship, except the fact that you would have the hardship of getting a little bit more money than you've been getting, see. But I think the registration fee would be all right, and also the ticket, because I ain't no trouble buying it.
I think James Jackson's got probably more representatives at the convention than anybody else. What do you think about your vote?
Well, I think it's a question that'd be impossible to settle, no matter who discusses it, because you have so many opinions on the matter. But one angle to paying a registration fee, you'll get into this, and of course I'd have no objections to a higher registration fee. I'm not opposed to it. But once it was included in the restoration fee and was paid, then whether or not you'd be able to get attended the banquet, the money would still be there. And you have some folks just going to go off on their own no matter what you do. Even if they're supposed to be there, they ain't. But, you know, this is the...
One other thing, too, you may be thinking about maybe sending three or four delegates. Mm-hmm. You send that many delegates to one local union, you're going to file up and put some money there.
Right.
And they've got it. If they register for the convention, they've got to go to that thing or else.
It's either go or lose the fee, right? That's what it amounts to.
Well, let's hear from Sister Bert out here.
Well, Carl, most of the time, though, on registration fees, we're not questioned, but James knows in our local where this expense is, it comes up. They really put up to the wall on that thing.
Well, our people would have to take a ticket out of the normal expense they allowed. They wouldn't vote them any more money.
That's what we've done before, say. See, we were allowed so much for the night meal, and we just paid the extra on that $6. Which, I mean, it worked out all right that way. Right. But just whatever the board thinks is best, I mean. But I'm
well, the executive board, as a matter of fact, the executive committee, this has been the practice, the executive committee has always established the restoration fee. This time we went up $1 on it to try to help pay some of the additional costs. You know, this cost keeps going up as far as our operation's concerned. And in the $4, frankly, it just scratches the surface as far as the expense of a convention's concerned. $4 doesn't come anywhere near taking care of the cost.
Well, what would we need? $10, $20,
$50? Well, if you said it, by the time we come to another convention, a $10 restoration fee would, if you include a banquet in this, and we wouldn't even have $4 to fly against the cost.
We'd wind up about $2.50, $2.50,
yeah,
and
see what I mean. So,
on the expense of the convention, while we wind up with a $10 fee.
See, this is, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move that this body here give consideration to a fee for registration. That fee to be set by the executive committee with the approval of the next session of the executive board. The approval or disapproval of the next session of the executive board, that this board here recommend or defeat an increased registration to take care of the needs of a banquet or a jamboree or whatever it might be. And that fee be set by the executive committee and presented to the next meeting of the executive board.
In other words, what your motion is that this might be referred to the board after this convention for consideration, and that they instruct the executive committee concerning the matter prior to the next convention.
That's correct.
We got a second on that motion.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Under discussion, I just want to say a couple of things that I agree with Brother Edwards' motion. In the first place, this board seated you today. This is the last time they'll officially meet until after the election. Some of us may not even be in the next board meeting. And we should leave the decision about the convention 2 years from now to whoever the officers are going to be at that time.
This is my
opinion. Then there's one other point I think that we ought to bear in mind. cost of stuff 2 years from now would be pretty vague to figure on right now. I really believe you'd have to be near to the time of the convention to know what cost you're talking about.
Well, I think that that the convention delegates ought to have a say-so in this convention of whether they want that increase or want the executive committee and board of next board to study that out and do that. I mean, because some of the convention delegates here now, let them vote on
it. Well, that's a little
but we can recommend.
The motion that's
right. I think we ought to recommend that his motion to the committee. I mean, do the convention and let the convention flow it. Decide whether they want the committee to do that.
We have further discussion on the motion. And the motion, frankly, is what it amounts to is refer this thing to the new board to be elected at this convention for consideration. We have any further discussion? Not all in favor of the motion, signify it by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Well, I really didn't have that on the agenda for this meeting. We got to get by accident. A couple of things that was mentioned in these minutes that I think we ought to touch on briefly and probably take action on one. You noticed in those minutes we talked about the suit on property equalization that was to be filed by Attorney Wiesenberg. And I've come to the conclusion that our good friend Wiesenberg has been playing games with us. We had a meeting with him, it's been over a year ago, and then we had this last action, and I sent him word, and we still haven't heard anything from him. So if it meets the approval of the group here, I'm going to terminate our relationship with the good attorney and take another look at this situation later on with another attorney if we still want to go this route. There is a good possibility that this whole thing will be considered by the legislature anyhow. So if there's no objection here, I'm going to just simply, by unanimous consent, approach the attorney about, you know, withdrew their services, something we never did get out of them anyhow. Anybody disapprove of that?
Has it been paid?
No, sir. No money's passed in the hand yet. If they had, I'd been raising all kinds of sin about it.
You don't want to know anything about this, though. I think we're going to need a good judgment.
All right. Okay. We will do that. Another thing that we think need to just briefly touch on in passing is the Council on Economic Education. You read in the minutes there where we made a contribution and we urged the local unions to also make contributions, and we did raise several thousand dollars in this effort. And I was advised by the Lieutenant Governor's office not too long ago that the universities I think it's about four of them, Ole Miss, Southern, Alcorn, and where's the other one? Delta State. Those four, the seminars, the workshops are being set up this summer. As a matter of fact, they're currently in progress. And of course, we did attend the clergy council thing. This one didn't go up as good this time as it should have, Brother Jackson, because we had so many conflicts.
Right. But
they've all assured me, and I'm sure they've assured you, that the next time around they'll check this thing out a little more carefully where there won't be so many conflicts and we'll get better attendance from the minutes.
I'd like to say a word on that. Last year, we had very favorable comments from this conference from the pastor of my church, and he made a request that I let him know a little in advance of when the next one would be held, and that he certainly wanted to be in attendance. Well, it just so happened that I received nothing on it whatsoever. And until after it had been held. I happened to be talking with Brother Knight one day, asked him, when's this going to be held? And he said, that was 2 weeks ago.
So he barely left Mason sent out. They didn't send me any forms for about 10 days before the conference. And I sent them the clause, but I'd be in town.
Right. So if we're going to participate in this and ask other people to participate in it, why, I think we certainly are due the information in the field.
And that much consideration.
Sure.
Well, I think that we'll get better cooperation in the future. We got a new fella coming in taking Grubbs' place.
Right.
You met him yet?
I hadn't met him.
Well, he seems to be a real fine person. And frankly, after our frank discussion about this follow-up, I think we'll get better cooperation in the future. All right, now listen, I've got a number of things that we need to act on here this afternoon, in addition to things brought up by the minutes. Let me cite you a couple of things we've got to do. We've got to review and approve or disapprove the resolutions that are being presented by the executive board. We've got to review and approve the committee assignments. And we want to talk about the possibility of a breakfast for the Lady Duchess. This is three items that we've got to act on here this afternoon. So I'm going to first take up the committee assignments. I want to advise you now that we've left some room for additions to all of the committees. Under the Constitution, we can... They're not in there. We'll pass them out to you after I've read them all. There's room for additions on all of them. Under the Constitution, we can't go over 15. Well, none of them run over 9 or 10. So keep in mind, if you got anybody you want to add, they can be added here this afternoon. On the Audit Committee, which has already performed its duties, is J.K. Culliford, Chairman, Bill Thompson, D.W. Tyson. Restoration and Credentials Committee, James Jackson, Chairman, Linda D. Hawks, Rosa Eva Mack, Audrey Berriman.
Perriman.
Perriman.
Pete.
Okay, we correct you. Stand corrected. Amy Hollowell, Mildred Andrews, Bill C. Williams, Floyd Berry. Officers Report, George Johnson, Chairman, Edward Henry, Thomas Neatcase, Claude Porter, Porter Broom. Constitution and Bylaws. And let me say here that we set up a subcommittee in line with the board's recommendation a couple of years ago to review the Constitution and make some recommended changes at this convention. And that subcommittee is as follows: James Fitzhugh, Chairman, Robert E. Thomas, and John Erickson. That was the subcommittee. They've been working quite extensively, and they will have a number of proposed changes at this convention. In addition to those three, we've added Wayman Goodman, L.D. Clark, May Tynes, Glenn Canfield, B.C. Smith, James Lawrence, and Albert Price. On the Resolutions Committee, E.B. Edwards, Chairman, Herbert Williams, J.O. Lee, Lois Hampton, W.H. Wood, Maggie Shepherd, T.P. McNeil, Raymond Tucker, and Elijah Lovett, Jr. Legislative Committee, C.E. Schaefer, Chairman, J.W. Rainey, Clark Massey, E. Burdette, E.M. Grantham, Laura Bland, Paul Burleson, Robert Denley, and Sarah Buckley. Rules Committee, Marvin Taylor, Chairman, John McDaniel, J.B. Lott, Jimmy Shepherd, Wayne Burcham,
Scratch Burcham,
Brenda Hinton, and Mary Ward. Scratch Burcham, and who do we put in his place?
We don't know. We haven't put anybody. There'd be an alternate delegate there tonight.
You want to put his alternate, whoever it is? Is that all right for the group here? Well, I'm going to give them all to you, and then we'll come back. If you got anybody you want to sign to some of them, then we'll come back. I want you to hear them all so you know who's on what committee. Organizing Committee. Cornelius Forrest, Chairman, Ray Smithart, Ernest Curtis, Joe Sant, Dan Ory, R.H. Bobo, Leonard Gardner, Wayne White, and J.B. Hanna.
Union Label, Mabel Snowden, Chairman, C.A. Dunlap, P.E. Schumake, Mildred Evans, Prentice Sutton, Dan Butler, Mrs. Mary Lovett. I understand that Mabel won't be here.
No,
so
she was here yesterday.
All right, yeah. Give me a good ACWA person to chair this committee. Think about it a little bit.
All right, give me a
don't have to.
Well,
yeah.
Mildred Evans won't be here.
Who?
Mildred Evans. Barnhill is the delegate.
Who?
L.H. Barnhill.
L.H. Barnhill? Did a rebel with submit his name in place of Evans? Is that all right with everybody? How you spell that? B-A-R?
B-A-R-N-H-I-L-L.
And what organization? Is this IBW?
Same one.
Same local? All right. What we've done is try to split it up, scatter them around. We want preferably an ACWA person to chair this committee because they will be giving away some shirts, a suit, and what have you, and be on the Union Label program as they usually are. So I'm going to depend on Jackson and our other good ACWA people to submit a chairman for this committee if it's all right with everybody. Educational Committee, H.H. Robbins, Chairman, T.G. Beckham, Rex Womack, Jimmy Matkins, James R. Jones, Neil M. Jaco, Hubert L. Summons, Myrtle Edwards, E.L. Smith, and John Mercer. Cope Committee, Robert Woodson, Chairman, S.H.D.'s, D.R. Sossaman, Ruth Scallions, Idell Rigby, Doris Miller, Sarah Buckley, W.G. Price, L.J. Brown, and M.A. Mooneyham. Mooneyham, that is. Sergeant at Arms, Z.L. Barnes, J.E. Terry Jr., and Prentice Dawkins. And we still will have to set up an elections committee after we see whether we're going to have an election or not. And I've got some people in mind, of course, and it depends on whether they're nominated for office or not. So we can't pick this one until we know where we are there.
Back to your legislative committee. Flora Bland will not be here.
All right, legislative.
In her place, and I forget his name.
Which one? Which one?
Flora Bland?
Flora Bland.
Flora's not going to be here.
All right.
I don't love her.
That is an ACWA person. All right, then y'all going to have to give us a couple of names. From what we've done is try to pick these out where we got some from the different groups. And it's got them around as much as possible.
Claude, did I not hear you call Sarah Buckley's name out?
Sarah is on the,
well,
what is
I
it,
thought
Coke
I
committee?
Heard you call her name out on for another committee before then.
Sarah Buckley?
I thought I did. Sarah's on Coke. But I thought I heard him.
No, we haven't got her on
before.
One, I don't think.
Well, I thought I heard you call
her. Yes, you have. She's on legislative.
Yeah, I thought it was
all
on
right,
two
we'll
different
strike calls. Her off for one. That's right. She's on Coke. Did we make that mistake, Mr. Miller? Well, I was too worried about garbage to give you one piece of
it. Well, somebody should change the drag, man.
Yeah, let's strike off the legislative to leave her on court.
Swell in. Get turned on.
Where have we got the wide chairman at on this thing?
We don't.
She's not an official delegate, so we can't put her on that. All right, would you two CWA people be kind enough to find us a CWA person, delegate, to serve on the legislative committee?
One that brother here.
What committee did you have Flora on, Tom?
On the legislative, her and Sarah both. Yeah.
CWA, what about Joe Pennell?
The chairman, we're going to give the chairman. Now, let's get to the chairman.
Mayor Smith is a
delegate. Want to put her, Mayor Smith, would be a good person on legislative, too, wouldn't it? You're right with everybody, if you insert her name in place of Sarah Buckley. What's her name, first name?
Mary.
Mary Smith. Mary Smith. Well, make that correction there, Jack, on your committee on the legislative. Scratch Flora Bland and scratch Sarah Buckley and add Mary Smith.
No, it's the chairman's on one.
Yeah.
The chairman,
they should have them so they can scratch them now.
I'm gonna have to make all these changes.
We're gonna pass them around where they make these changes.
Now, does anyone have anybody that they'd like to recommend a name to any of these committees that we've called out? As I indicated earlier, we've allowed room to add some to them. If any of you got somebody in mind you'd like to put to work on one of these committees.
On this legislative committee to replace Flora Brainerd, let's put Bonnie Bridges on that and make see that day.
Bonnie Bridges?
Yeah, and on the Union Labor Committee where we struck maybe.
B-O-N-N-E-Y?
Bonnie, B-O-N-N-I-E.
I-E, Bridges?
Bridges, she's flying on. And on the Union Labor Committee where we struck Mabel Snowden, insert Ruth White, she's the new president of our car rent local. She replaced WAAP left as their president.
Union Labor, Ruth White?
Ruth White.
All right.
Bridges,
now, does anyone else have any delegate that they'd like to add to any of the committees? How about you, Bob?
He's not already on a committee, which I don't recall hearing his name. I'd like to add Charlie Holmes to the court committee.
Well, we got a problem there.
Is he an official?
We got a problem there. The local is going to affiliate effective August the 1st.
I didn't know.
They're down here, but it would be a little bit hard to appoint him to a committee when he's here really as a guest. He's been seated. Tucker and them both are here, but they really won't be affiliated.
Oh, they're not official. Okay, then that's
we had him in mind. You know, we wanted to put him on that committee. Yeah.
On that coat. Whole committee. I don't think he has Joe Frank anymore.
Put Joe Frank on there?
I think it'd be good. Maybe learn something to give the membership by collecting $6.
You want him on there with you, man?
Put him on something.
What do you think about getting Joe What?
Which one you want him on, Dave?
It don't matter, just so he's not on that.
Hey.
Don't want him on the
one. One of us, enough, that local old coat. Yeah. I knew Woodson was chairman of it, and that's what I didn't think that was a coat committee.
Well, now we got Wayne Burcham up here on rules that he's from the Tupelo area, isn't he? Or up in that area. Why don't we put Joe Frank on there in his place?
I just have to get him on the call.
All right, Joe. F-R-A-N-K?
F-R-A-N-K-S.
Thanks. That'll be Brother Taylor, you chairman of the Rules Committee. Would you make that correction on your list? Scratch Wayne Burcham, and in his place add Joe Frank. Joe Frank.
In Flora Brainerd's place on legislative.
Yeah, Brother Shoemaker's got his hand up.
Possible to not get him. He had Cock added to legislative.
Legislative.
From Local 87 Jackson.
What'd you say?
Local 87. He's from Local 87 in Jackson.
Who, Rainey?
Adcock.
No.
Adcock.
Well, we got Rainey on there already.
Yeah, he had a mayor.
We don't want to try to get, we've got to kind of keep it spread out a little bit. Many groups and representatives we can. This would give us two men on the same committee from the same local.
We're trying to entice him to start working with Rainey up there on lobbying some of these bills, and he's real good, and he really needs.
Is he going to be a delegate?
He's a delegate, and he needs the experience.
We haven't got anybody yet. You.
Adcock. Any Adcock.
Is it all right we put Mr. Adcock on the legislative committee?
I think so.
His name is what, John?
M-E.
Adcock. M-E?
Yes.
A-D-C-O-C-K? A-D-C-O-C-K?
What did I say, man? M-E? It's McKee, M-C-K-E-E.
Huh?
McKee, I said M-E. It's McKee, M-C-K-E-E.
McKee Adcock?
Yes.
M-C.
K-double-E?
Yes.
T. Adcock. All right, any other?
Somebody mentioned one in Evans' place on Union Lake. Well, that was Barnes.
Barnes Hill.
Who is it?
Elliot Barnes.
Elliot.
Yeah, I made that change in my mind, Elliot Barnes Hill. All right, do we have any other changes, suggestions, recommendations? Did I get it?
Do we add one to Sergeant Barnes?
Yeah.
Three, like that, R. Bryant from Hattiesburg.
Is he a Delaware?
No, he's not a Delaware.
Yeah.
Is he?
Raymond, local 184.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I was talking about Raymond.
I thought, yeah. Raymond's his son.
Yeah, Raymond.
What's his name?
Raymond, he's a delegate to the convention.
Raymond?
You thought I was talking about Ray, didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah, that's who I thought you were talking about, also.
He's got two sons.
They're
both
Raymond Bryant?
Raymond and Richard.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
Four, I got a man I kind of like. I'm going to like these. I'd like to get the hip to sell that coat thing back there. I'm ready if you got another opening there.
Yeah, we put him on there. We left room. We hadn't added anything to the coat.
Put Earl Melton down there.
Earl Melton?
Yeah.
All right.
I'd like to get his kind of hip out on that thing. We've got him involved. He's doing it.
Who's chairman of the legislative committee?
Schaefer.
Woodson, you making that note on your copy?
I'd like
you make that change on yours, Bob? Earl Melton.
I'd like to suggest a name on your legislative committee. It's B.A. Stanford.
What's the name?
B.A. Stanford, S-T-A-N-F-O-R-D.
P.A.?
B.
B.A. Stanford?
Uh-huh.
What organization is he?
C.W.A.
B.A. Stanford.
T-A-N-F-O-R-D. Local 3517, CWA.
Claude, we might mention here for the benefit of the chairman, and we'll mention this again in the convention hall. We'll have four parlors such as this available day and night beginning tomorrow morning. So we'll announce them, and any time your chairman wants me to, you the first come, first serve. Just get your group together and head for one of the parties.
You don't have to make reservations at that parlor.
We'll try to announce where you're going to be meeting at, especially the ones that's going to have quite a bit of work to do, rules and audit, residential, officers report, or committees such as this won't need a large room, but the Constitution and bylaws, resolutions, legislative, educational committee, and groups and committees such as this, the COPE committee, are going to have a pretty good sized place to meet at. Brother Taylor, the second, has got your rules prepared for you already. You will just matter of you getting them together with your committee and see if they meet your approval.
I'll swap with you, Brother Taylor. I'll swap with you.
That'll cost you.
All right, do we have any more additions?
There wasn't any changes on Constitution or Resolution.
No changes on Constitution or Resolution, right. All of these chairmen got the changes now that were made. All right, do we have a motion to approve the committees as changed or corrected?
I'll so move.
Second.
Any further discussion? Not all in favor of the motion, signify it to say an aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried, and so ordered. All right, I've got that out of the way. Now, on these resolutions, all of you were sent copies of them that were drafted by various people on the subjects that were suggested. Would you, I don't see any point in reading a whole resolution. To meet your approval, I'm going to ask Brother Knight just to simply read the resolve portion of the resolution to conserve time. Is this all right with you? Everybody should have already had a chance to read them and study them.
Since that first one's already mailed out.
The first one is not to be considered here. That first one is submitted by the resolution number one, was submitted by the Columbus Central Labor Council. Therefore, it does not have to be considered at this meeting.
I was just going to move that we referred it to the committee. committee. That's in the committee, and I understand that the committee is going to come up with a committee substitute, and they will be getting into that. Brother Clark, you are on that committee, so you will have an opportunity to have your say on that particular matter. All right, does it meet your approval? We'll start with resolution number 2 and ask Brother Knight to read the resolve part, and then we'll discuss the matter and dispose of the resolution. Brother Knight.
Everybody got number 2, page 2, same song?
Page 1.
Page 1, resolution 2.
Well, it starts on page 1. The title, resolution number 2, affiliation. Of course, the resolve starts on page 1. I'll therefore be it resolved.
Let the delegates to the 5th Annual Convention of the Mississippi AFL-CIO call upon all international unions to affiliate their unaffiliated local with the state AFL-CIO and the local central body in their respective area, and be it further resolved that the international union be urged to immediately initiate an effective affiliation program. And be it finally resolved that copies of this resolution be sent to the president of each international union with unaffiliated locals in Mississippi, to President George Meany, Secretary Treasurer Lane Kirkland, and the coordinator of state and local central bodies, Stan Smith.
What's your pleasure?
Move to be adopted.
Motion to adopt the resolution has been offered.
Second.
We did have a second. We're having a discussion on resolution number 2. Not all in favor of the motion signify it by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, motion carried and so ordered. We'll now take up resolution number 3. Yes.
Is the board going to refer these to proper committees?
Yes, I'll come back to this after we get through with them. I've got them already referred, and after we get through with them, then I'll go over and tell you which has got what resolution after we get them through. Brother Clark.
Kevin, I have a question. I believe everybody has read these things. They all had copies of them. Unless there's one particular they want to discuss on there, can we just kind of adopt them?
Well, we can do it in one motion if you want to. It would save a lot of time.
I move that we adopt them.
Adopt and approve all the resolutions.
That's what
I'm saying. That's what I'm saying.
Gentlemen, some of these things need discussing before we just adopt them blind.
I said unless you need
discussion. Yeah, we have one in particular that needs to be discussed.
Too long to read the resolution for me. The resolve part.
Well, you could still do that thing up the one which you wanted to discuss. I said unless you want to discuss one. Well, it's up to the board. What's your pleasure, you know? You want to adopt them all in one motion, or you want to adopt some of them in one motion and
let's
take
adopt
up some
single. Let's take them one by one and adopt it. Make
resolution
a motion to adopt it.
Number 3, all right? We can do it that way. Resolution number 3. Do you want to read that one, review it? Not that we have a motion to adopt resolution number 3.
Right.
We have a motion to adopt resolution number 3?
Yes, move it up.
Okay, second?
Okay.
Who was the second?
I'll second.
Brother Grant. All right, we're having a discussion. Not all in favor of resolution number 3, signify it by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carried, so ordered. Resolution number 4, political education. Do we have any discussion or on the resolution number 4, political education?
Move it to adopt.
Motion to adopt resolution number 4. We have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to adopt resolution number 4, signify it by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Resolution number 5, legislative fund.
Move it to adopt.
Motion to adopt resolution number 5. We have a second?
Second.
All in favor of the resolution, signify it by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Now, we're going to probably get into some pretty good discussion on this one at the convention, what the purpose of it is. We want
won't belabor you with that at this time. Resolution number six, regulation of the insurance industry. Do we have any discussion or comment on this resolution? We have a motion to adopt it.
I would have just a little discussion.
The resolution?
On resolution number six, I would like to see this resolution put in the paper.
Well, we hope that all of them will be given some press coverage.
We know some of them are.
Paper today covered part of them, didn't it? Paper today covered part of them, didn't it?
Might have. I haven't seen the paper. Which paper did you get, Clarence?
Yeah.
All right. Any discussion on this one?
Particular number.
Motion was to adopt, I believe. We have any discussion? All in favor of the motion to adopt resolution number six, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, motion carried, and so ordered. Number seven, union label and service trade. It's a standard resolution that we usually adopt. Any discussion on resolution number seven?
I move it be adopted.
Motion to adopt resolution number seven. We do have a second. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to adopt number seven, signify by saying aye.
Uh-huh.
All opposed, motion carried, and so ordered. Number eight, organizing the unorganized. How about that one?
I'll make a motion to adopt.
Motion to adopt, that's a good one. That's a real little Bob Stoner's old testament.
Gentlemen?
Yeah.
Before we adopt this, I think we ought to read that first, that second paragraph there. State government through its research development branch has adopted a slogan conceived by Ambleforth, designed only to confuse Ambleforth for 75 by 75. Suppose the meaning of this outfit will raise the per capita income of Mississippi to 75% of the national average by 1975. I think this, some way or another, this could probably be worded just as good. Unless we have enough problems up there, and I'm sure he can testify to this, without words like this in a resolution. That's about next to worst wrote resolution I've ever heard of. And then down on the last, in the last paragraph, when they refer to the labor movement as just a bunch of nuts, turn it right around and try to slap them in the face with a development bunch. Now, if you don't put them in a stalk like bananas, just pick them off one at a time. Not try to pick them off all at one time.
Brother Sponge, would you like to defend language in that resolution?
Well, I'm just tired messing with that bunch of imbeciles up there when they try to tell me they're going to raise the wages of the people in the state of Mississippi to 75% of the national average by 1975. I think they're fools. I don't want the wages of Mississippi raised to 75% of the national average. I want them raised up to the national average. And the way they're going at it, opposing every effort of organized labor to improve conditions and improve wages in every contract negotiation we have, by fighting us when we strike, by fighting us in any other way, how can you consider them to be a friend? And what are they doing to raise wages to 75% of anything?
Them raising wages beside the point.
That's what I'm talking about there.
What I'm talking about is the wording of that second paragraph there. And I think, you don't vote on it, but I'm sure against it. Horrible.
Hey, if you don't think their influence has changed, you're not going to change my mind.
It's not worried with you to get substituted.
It doesn't matter to me if it doesn't even pass. Cause I'm against that word. Now it can be worded different because it's just not my way of thinking that this makes it in this resolution nice or something. Or it's not gonna help it none whatever.
Well, this resolution is
It's a good resolution.
On behalf of our membership and the unorganized workers, and not behalf of the business community. That's for sure. We're not presenting this thing to curry favor with the Chamber of Commerce and nobody like that. It's the benefit of our own people.
I think we hurt our own people when we refer to people that it don't matter whether they've been against our policies or for us or anything else. I think it hurts the labor movement a good deal when you put something like this, and if it hits a Clarion Ledger or a big paper, and AFL-CIO jumps out, it just jumps out at everybody.
Well, what's your pleasure with the resolution?
I favor the resolution itself. I think it's a good thing, but I think maybe I might agree with them a little bit on that, on this particular part of it. Although they're not friends of ours, I don't know what that would help or not.
The resolution should probably be adopted, but there should be some change in the wording of it.
What substitute would you be for you?
Has adopted a slogan and mark out conceived by AFL-CIO, designed on to confuse AFL-CIO. A slogan, period. Of 75 by 75 supposed to mean this outfit raised capital income tax, capital income in Mississippi. And down where you have development bunch.
Where is that?
That's in the bottom paragraph, the fourth line. I don't know where it's development committee or what, but I know it's not bunch.
Well, let me make a suggestion to you here. This resolution is already in the kit. And it'll just about have to be considered as it is here by the committee. The committee, if you want to give the committee some instructions about making some corrections in the committee, I suggest that be done this way instead of the board making the changes here. If there's any of you would like to be placed on this committee, I'm just looking it over here. This is one of the few committees that we don't have a member of the board on. If one of you would like to volunteer to serve on this committee, I'd be happy to put you on it and let you meet with the committee that's going to consider the resolution and let them bring out the changes that you might have in mind. Would you like to be on that committee, Brother Shoemaker?
Yes, I would. I'd like to change.
All right, let's see what committee did I have him on to start with.
Union Label.
Huh?
Union Label.
All right, you can be on both of them for that. Well, let's put you on that instead of Union Label. That meet everybody's approval?
Which committee is that?
Put him on organizing instead of Union Labor. That meet everybody's approval?
Yeah.
And if I can make a facetious suggestion before I go out and check on his air conditioning, if you don't like the word imbecile, I have a facetious suggestion to make substitute illegitimate children.
All right. No resolution number eight.
Mr. Chairman, before we leave this, I have an addition that I would like to see incorporated in this. Down in the last part where we copies of this resolution to be sent to the various people, I think a copy of this should be sent to the Mississippi Research and Development people.
Brother Shoemaker, would you you want to make this as a motion?
Yeah, I make it a motion that
the copy of the resolution be sent to the R&D Center after it's adopted by the convention.
Yeah, right.
All right, we get a second to that motion.
I'll second.
Any discussion? All in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Brother Shoemaker, you will so advise the committee. All right. Now, on the resolution itself, do we have a motion to adopt it?
Made the motion a long time ago.
We haven't adopted it, though.
No.
Okay, we ready for the motion?
Ready.
All in favor of adopting resolution number 8, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. On resolution 9, collective bargaining for public and other employees. What's your pleasure on that, resolution number 9?
Move to adopt.
Motion to adopt it by Brother Whitson. We get a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor of the resolution, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Resolution number 10, national health insurance. We have any discussion on that resolution? We have a motion to adopt it. Motion and a second. Do we have any discussion? All in favor of the resolution, the motion to adopt resolution number 10, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Resolution number 11, State Police Force.
I think this one should be thrown out, discarded, done away with. It's the most misleading bunch of junk, really, that I've seen yet. The very thing that the people here have, the only thing almost to protect them, and to come up here and run it down like this, I don't see it. I don't understand it. I know the things they have mentioned here, such as the Gestapo, they refer to it as Gestapo. They wantonly shot up a lady's dormitory at Jackson State College. The false and misleading is not the fact that they didn't shoot it, but the fact that the what happened there. I live there, and this was such, until this all came about, when I got ready to go to work in the morning, it was not safe for me to go. I had to put a gun in my car. And no one should have to do that. They should be able to go anywhere, drive anywhere, anytime. I know the day after this happened, you could go anywhere over Jackson and you were not molested, you're not bothered, you didn't have to worry about anything, you leave your gun at home. I think it's just bad, really. It's just about the worst thing we've had yet. I think it should be thrown out.
Well, I guess I'm gonna have to defend that resolution because I wrote it myself. Now let me bring you up to date on this situation in order that we fully understand what we're talking about. And as the resolution points out, the legislature in 1964 doubled the highway patrol and gave it certain police powers that it did not have prior to 1964. And if you will remember, during the legislative session of 1964 and the bulletins that we mailed out, we warned that the legislature was in the process of establishing a state police force, or Gestapo, in the state of Mississippi. And I would simply remind you folks that we have it, that they moved in on the Gulf Coast and usurped the authority of the local governing authorities right up and down this beach without the proper authority. They've been used in labor disputes around about this state to arrest our own members on strike. They set up camp and law in Mississippi to arrest those people when the Masonite people were out on strike. They've arrested individual citizens to no end throughout this state. And whether we like it or not, we do have a Gestapo and the highway patrol. And what all this resolution does, frankly, is to call upon the state legislature to put them back where they were prior to 1964 and patrol the highways only. That's what it's calling for.
Well, I'd like to say one thing about it. I understand what you're trying to say in it, but I think one thing that's sitting wrong in it is if you'd consider marking out this incident maybe that happened at the Jackson State College is, if because a lot of people are looking at these riots all over the, not just Jackson, I'm not singling out just Jackson, I don't care where it's at, all over the United States, all races of people, they're doing nothing but demonstrating, and having riots, and tearing up, burning, and I think the people are fed up with it, and I think this is what's going to hurt your motion to get it passed here, and I would ask that maybe the referring to the dormitory of the state of Jackson State would be removed from this
resolution. Let me say a word or two about the Jackson State situation. I personally visited the campus the day after this thing happened out there. I went through that dormitory. I'm a former military policeman, and I have some idea about what I'm looking at. And this building was deliberately shut up with automatic weapons. There's no way in the world that you can justify it having happened, regardless of who might have done it. And it's pretty well been established already by various investigative groups that it was the highway patrol that pulled the trigger in this situation. The police, according to the best information, did not fire a shot. There was no attempt made to disperse the mob, if there was a mob, by tear gas or anything else before this took place.
I was familiar with what happened that night. Also, the guard was there, had orders, well, issued live ammunition, had orders to shoot. The police were there and did shoot. The highway patrol did shoot first. They did use automatic weapons. They did fire after being fired at, after being bricks and concrete and bottles had been, as they say, pelted with bricks and concrete and bottles. And they did fire back after having been fired at. They did do that. Now, regardless of what it looked like the day after, I was a former infantryman myself, and I know what it looks like. But that doesn't alter the fact that they happened to be there. These people had no business being there in this girl's dormitory, and there should have been some effort to have gotten them out. And when someone's firing at you, you don't throw or tear gas or put water hoses on them. You've got to stop it somewhere or another. This is just, a lot of this is false and misleading here, that I know of personally. And the way it's set up here, and I know personally, you say the harassment, there's no doubt there has been. You got harassment in different sections of the place. I'll agree with you on that. Not necessarily by the highway patrol, because I know some of the highway patrolmen are pro-labor, that they have actually protected the people you have out there. And I can give you personal cases of that. Some, as you say, you're right on. And also in your sheriffs and other things, though. But you're lumping a whole group up here, and you're destroying a good thing just trying to get it maybe, say, two or three different people here.
Well, I like to say on this particular resolution, and I don't guess it really matters whether the resolution is passed with this wording or not, because as he stated, I was in the area also that night, and then what happened was happened without any provocation from the students. There was no riot there, and I would like to add that I'm not speaking with a prejudiced tongue, that this resolution expresses exactly what happened on Jackson State campus that night. Now, as I say, whether it's adopted or not, I don't guess it really matters, because what happened happened. And I don't think any attempt to leave it out would justify what happened on campus.
Well, that's not the purpose of the resolution. That we just mentioned that has been one of the things that's been done by the Highway Patrol since it was given police power in the state.
Well, the fact that they were on the campus protecting it after being asked to be in there, there'd been no denying of what has been some supporters, but the fact that they were hit with bottles, were hit with concrete, were shot at, and if that doesn't give you some reason to do something to protect state property that us taxpayers are having to pay for, that doesn't belong to them. It doesn't matter what college it is or where it is, as long as you got state property and you got the lives of the people here at hand, you got something else.
Let's see if we can't get a little order here, and we'll take it one at a time. Those that want to speak on the resolution, Brother Schaefer, if I've got the floor right now.
I just said that the only property damage was caused by the state police.
Well, who told you that? Man, my Sunday school class lost a bunch of heavy equipment up there. It was burned in the street.
That was street. That wasn't state property.
His ownership, what it was on the campus, that's what we burned.
City police didn't protect it.
His property
on the street. That was their job. I'm talking about state property, which is only jurisdiction the highway patrol should have.
Anybody else? Brother Clark?
I've got a, well, I've been voiced objection to a couple of places where, practically, that one president of a local union told me that he had men in the highway patrol and that they were upset. They still had their card and here local, and they were upset putting all of them in the same category there, that they were dangerous men carrying guns, and they said they also, according to the Gestapo over there, they kind of object to that because that reminded them that everybody was in Hitler's outfit, you know, dictated like that. They had to do it. And he said that in these situations, every one of them ain't got to do these things.
Who else wants the floor? What's your pleasure with resolution number 11?
I make a motion we reject resolution number 11.
I move to be tabled.
Motion is to what now?
Two motions.
Well, let's look the person now and get who offered the motion. Mike Daniel offers a motion to what?
Reject. I second the motion.
Motion and a second to reject the resolution. Brother Taylor.
Mr. Chairman, if it be in order, I'd like to offer a substitute motion that it be referred to the committee as was resolution number 8.
One second.
Well, let's see. You want to offer that as a substitute?
I'll withdraw my motion if he wants to make that one.
All right, you withdraw it, and your motion then will
I can't withdraw it, though, unless Dunbar withdraws the second.
Well, who seconded it?
I'd rather leave it in there and vote on it.
You'd rather what?
I'd rather vote on this.
You'd rather vote the motion to
reject? Right, vote the motion
reject.
To reject.
Well, Brother Taylor has offered a substitute motion to refer it to the committee, and we'll have to dispose of that substitute motion first.
You going to discuss it a little bit?
Yes, we can discuss the substitute motion. That's before the body now.
I think, more or less, well, this would probably be the basics for starting another one. The facts, what this merits in there, and I think it has got some good merit facts in there, such as patrolling the highways, safety, and things like that. I think that there are certain parts of this thing which well to be considered in the new motion. I mean, new resolution.
Brother Schaefer is chairman of the legislative committee, and that committee will be handling the resolution. So I'm sure he'll take under consideration any recommendations that might be presented by the board here.
I think that highway safety thing like that should definitely go into another one. You've got it in this one.
All right, the motion is that the resolution be referred to the committee with instructions to consider the
direction, Mr. Chairman. The motion, if I remember right, is to reject this resolution.
No, we got a substitute motion. We're taking up a substitute now. Brother Taylor, substitute motion. Let it be. Will you rephrase that again, Brother Taylor, so everybody understands?
Substitute motion to refer to the committee as was resolution number 8.
As was with the thinking of the board. You want some corrections? Okay. We got a second on that, didn't we?
No.
A second motion.
We got a second. All right. Now the motion is before the House. Do we have any discussion? If not, all in favor of the motion.
Hold it, Paul, before you vote on this. I'm not even sure in my own mind what we're doing here, and I'm not sure all the board members are. If we vote on this resolution, the substitute motion, and that passes, then what happens to the motion on the rejection?
Well, it's automatically killed.
Right, well, I just want to be sure everybody understood what we're voting
on. But if you vote this one down, then it'll be before the House.
Right, but if this motion passes, then the rejection motion is dead.
Well, that's right. That's right. It's killed with adoption of this motion.
Right, I just want to be sure everybody understood what we're voting
on. I didn't understand.
Are we ready for the motion? We're ready for the motion?
Ready.
All in favor of the motion presented by Brother Taylor, signify it by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
No.
Motion carried and so ordered. You'll take note of in a couple of votes against the motion. All right. Resolution number one is not to be considered here. That disposed now of the resolution.
For the information of everybody, the air conditioning is deep busted. And the engineers in there working on the unit now.
The coffee's about ready. You want to get the coffee now? Come back?
Let me make one remark.
Brother Schaefer's got a statement he wants to make.
If this resolution is referred to my committee or our committee, anyone here who wishes to express feeling on it, here before the committee, will be announced at the time.
Now, if y'all would get your pencils out, I'll tell you what committee is going to handle what resolution before we get the coffee. The chairman especially needs this information. Of course, we'll make these announcements to the convention tomorrow. Resolution number one will be considered by the Constitution and Bylaws Committee. Number two will be considered by the Resolutions Committee.
Number two.
Two is resolution.
Resolutions Committee. If you want to go through and mark your resolutions, this would be the best way to do it. Just get your resolutions and mark them.
Okay.
The idea of mine, just write on your resolution what committee has got. See? Resolution one, the Constitution Bylaws. Number two, the resolutions.
Yes, ma'am.
Number three, legislative. Number four, COPE. Number five, Resolutions Committee. Number six, Legislative Committee. Number seven, Union Labor Committee. Number eight, Organizing Committee. Number nine, Legislative Committee. Number 10, Educational Committee. We put that one in there. It could have well gone to legislative, but they didn't have a resolution to consider, and they might want to draw up another one of their own. But anyhow, we put that one in Educational. Number 10, I think that's the one on health insurance. Yeah.
Education.
Yeah, we give that to Education, because you've already
got legislative.
Number 11, Legislative Committee. Yeah, legislative committee. All right, can we get the coffee and come back now? Want to take a break for coffee? We don't have a whole lot. We got a couple of other items we need to get some action on. And before it slips my mind, I want to remind all of you, all members of the board, that there'll be a seat on the stage for you in the morning. You'll be expected to be up there for the opening round of the convention. And after the morning session, you don't have to be there. You can do whatever you please. But the opening session, we'd like to have all of you up there. Right, Dean?
I think you better rephrase part of that speech.
What's that?
They can do whatever they want.
Well, within reason. Within reason. Now, the matter we want to get a decision on here this afternoon involves a breakfast for all of the lady delegates and the lady guests and wives and what have you. Brother Knight has talked to the hotel people about the possibility of setting up and making an arrangement for Tuesday morning.
Yeah, we can do it.
For about what time?
Oh, I imagine.
9:30.
9:30. I
think
we better make it 8 o'clock.
Brother, you want to tell them what you think?
Well, I asked for two prices. One was donuts, the rolls, whatever you want to call it, juice and coffee. That's $1 for a person.
serve in the dining room. And that's tips and everything, $2. That's, you know, above the eggs, bacon, grits, and whatever.
One more question. You got the money, how it stands?
I think we can handle it. It won't cost us a maximum over $200, I think. The only thing we'll look for. But we ain't let none of you fellas go to that.
I just asked James not to put a skirt on. James not put a skirt on.
You'll never get by. You'll figure you'll never get by.
I know I will figure.
I'm not the secretary of the president, but they eat to the women now.
That behind me.
I knew we was going to get something started. We ain't got any order at all.
Let me say that.
All right.
I mean, connected with it. It's one of the reasons why. Is the fact that this has not been done in about 3 conventions. Debbie Sue doesn't know a lot of the women folks, a lot of them don't know her. Next year, we are going to try to put together a good political organization. We've been promised certain help from the national organization. And we feel like that this is most important. Now, we've got to have these women folks, these girls, but your information, the figure now, at AFL-CIO, women membership, out of the 13.5 million members, is 2.7 million women right now, and that number's increasing all along. And we have got to have these girls, not only women members, but the wives. We may even have a few wives we'll invite to this thing. But we feel like this is extremely important, looking towards our activities in 71.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we concur with your request and that it is however.
Second motion.
Any discussion?
Wait.
Not all in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Brother Knight, you will proceed, I presume. Now, are they going to let you attend this thing?
Well, I don't know about that. I might be the door minder or something like that. Throw my hat in and it stays in. I don't know.
Y'all know what it is, it's time to pay the bill.
Right.
Send him word.
Right.
I'll sign the bill and you're out of go.
Never have. Question raised as the board approved the officer's report. You received copies of it. It never has been anything formally done. Of course, if they don't like it, they eat me out and go ahead and write one themselves. That's about the best way to handle anything. Amendments to it, they're welcome to have it.
We've
got a committee on officers. Yeah, on officers, but only committee on well officers.
I got one other item down here that I want to review with you briefly, and this will conclude the items that I have to present to you. And we'll pass the rest of you, so whether we have any other business or not, Brother Taylor, I understand, has got a couple of resolutions that he'd like to present. After I get through this item, I'll give the floor to him and let him read his resolution. I placed before you there a copy of a news release that we got out of the office on July the 24th. This was Friday, last Friday. I'd like you to read that for a minute. And I want to talk to you about this particular situation briefly. If all of you had a chance to read that news release here.
Jackson, they just started.
Right after I was talking to you the other afternoon,
yeah.
I got home, turned the television on, that's the first thing I saw, and it did have just what you said on there.
Yeah, right.
Had the whole thing.
All right, I want to review with you just as hurriedly and briefly as I can the situation surrounding the city employees striking Jackson and the role that I played in this situation. It would take a couple of days to get into it in detail with you, and I don't propose to do that here this afternoon. I just want to tell you that the role I played in this situation is no different from the role that I played in many, many situations around the Box State. We had a similar situation in Pascagoula, where I, acting as I saw it and carried out the duties of my office in support of these people. The difference in the Pascagoula situation and the Jackson situation was that they stayed on strike only a week. We got them back on the job and completed negotiations and so forth. Without any fanfare, we didn't get a lot of publicity. There was some. We didn't have television cameras at the city council meeting and all that kind of junk that we had in Jackson. But the two situations were very similar. As far as dealing with the city council and the union was concerned, of course, I think all of you are familiar with what went on here. And I left the delegation several times to City Hall about this, not just this past time, but over a year ago, Brother Schaefer, Brother Whitson, several more of the people in the Jackson area attended those meetings. Now, the thing that I want to touch on with you here, and the reason I laid that news release before you for you to read, is that I am going to, well, I have, as a matter of fact, already advise some lawyers to prepare a suit to file in federal court concerning my constitutional rights. As I view it, they had no business in joining me in this situation with this court injunction. I certainly should have not been cited for contempt of court. And apparently they agree because result of me telling them I wanted a trial, they agreed to drop charges against myself and officials of the local Thursday afternoon. And they learned that I wanted to go to court. I wanted them to try me and prove that I was in contempt of court. Well, this was the last thing, of course, apparently, that they wanted to do. And in order to drop the charges against me, apparently they decided they had to drop them against the officials of the local union, which is well and good. This is what we were at. But my position is simply this, that we cannot, we positively cannot permit the judicial process to be misused in this state as it was in this situation. Therefore, I think the only way to prevent it from happening in the future is to take the course of action that I'm about to take. I would hope that this would meet the approval of the executive board. We have another situation in Vicksburg, which involves the Carpenters Union, an organizer that was arrested simply for passing out literature and put in jail and stayed almost all night. He was fined and convicted on several charges simply for exercising his constitutional rights. The Carpenters Union have engaged attorneys in this situation. They've gone into federal court and filed a suit of similar nature to the one that I'm proposing involving myself. We are going to do our best to break this kind of junk up. The Vicksburg situation, it's a little bit different from the city of Jackson thing because you had the employee involved, the sheriff's office involved, the county prosecuting attorney involved, and several other public officials involved. There's no question about there was a definite conspiracy here to deny this man his constitutional rights. But that is really the business of the Carpenters Union. And of course, we've been trying to do what we can to assist them. Well, I'm simply presenting to you this afternoon this proposal. I seek your support of me going into federal court on my constitutional rights as outlined in the state.
Lord, I think you know we're backing you on that thing. And
well, I know, but since we're having this board meeting going, since you know, I've been involved, I thought it was appropriate to bring it up at this board meeting and get your approval and disapproval, however you feel about it, Brother West.
Brother Ramsey, I certainly support you and openly solicit the support of this entire board. Because, as you know, I was involved in that situation.
I don't know why they didn't cite you. How come they didn't show you right now?
I wonder sometimes why they didn't cite me. Because I actually advocated striking more than he did. I even got out on the picket lines in the front of the city garage or whatever it might be and carried a picket sign. So it's
come
my
on, talk to him about
it's
that.
My conclusion. No, well that's okay, but it's my conclusion that it's more of not just a violation of Brother Ramsey's constitutional rights that have been committed here, but it's more of a personal attack on Brother Ramsey in an effort to denounce the entire labor movement in the state of Mississippi. This is what I think is involved.
I think so.
And I certainly think you should go through it.
Mr. Chairman, if you want a motion,
I'd like a motion that
whatever action you think is necessary, you say your committee, you're supposed to be in talking with them and meeting with them all the time, if you care about whatever action you think is necessary to get your job to where you think best. But
we got a second.
Same motion.
We have a discussion on that. Not all in favor of the motion, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I agree with the statement was made that they're after me as head of the organization to discredit the labor movement. There's no question about this.
They said that they're not just asking you that all of us.
I mean, they're all of you.
That's right. Yeah, but
you
know,
get it
not deep.
That
you.
That's right.
I got an editorial here that I brought down here that I'm going to ask Brother Knight to read for this group, and then I want you people to guess what paper this showed up in. Brother Knight, would you relieve me a little bit and read this editorial?
I know.
The title of this is Crisis Proves City Metal. No one ever wins in a labor strike. This, of course, is Thursday, July 23rd. Someone loses income, others lose a result of forfeited production, and an atmosphere of ill will often prevails for long after settlement. Yet 3 weeks of work stoppage against the city of Jackson, primarily in its sanitation department, which ended Tuesday with services resumed Wednesday, has produced some effective results all the way around. Without elaboration on the merits or demerits of the dispute, people of Jackson have proved to themselves that they can meet and react to a crisis of such personal involvement. Those strikers who stayed off their jobs to great personal sacrifice in most instances are to be commended for their calm and strife-free conduct. Jackson's official family maintained its balance, as did the people of Jackson and the labor organization involved, finally resulting in a certain give and take on both sides to an amenable resumption of service. What has happened in Jackson during this period speaks of the finest kind of clear thinking and should set a pattern for other municipalities which find themselves involved in dispute of like nature. Such has not been the case in some of our neighboring cities, but Jackson can take pride and well-deserved applause for its conduct during this period.
It didn't come in court.
Does anybody want to guess what paper this was in? Have not read it already?
Could have well been in the Marion Star.
The what? It's date-lined editorial page, Jackson Daily News.
We got one.
Would you believe that the Jackson
Daily News?
We had one similar to Clarence Ledger.
Well, I didn't think so.
The editorial carried something very similar to that about Jackson.
I thought you'd be interested in that.
No, it didn't come calling.
All right.
Or too close.
Let's get on with the meeting here. Brother Taylor I brought with him a couple of resolutions that he'd like to present to the board. See if you want to consider them. And present them to this convention, or what's your pleasure. You might want to referred him to the incoming board at the convention 2 years from now. I don't know, but anyhow, Brother Taylor, you got the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We sailed through those 11 or 12 so easily and so rapidly.
You felt like we needed to use some time.
So I felt like it wouldn't be indulging too much to offer a couple here, and I think we will offer motion at the last that possibly be referred to the legislative committee. Open for discussion from this group. Anyway, here it is, resolution number, ?
That would be 12.
Whereas the General Treasurer of the State of Mississippi has now a surplus of more than $60 million, and whereas in the past, under similar circumstances, various selfish groups using all kinds of pressure tactics were able to secure appropriations for questionable projects and enterprises not always in the best public interest, in just a few short months, the surplus would vanish with the deficit taking its place, requiring another round of spiraling tax increases, as was the case, and raising the sales tax to 5%, lowering the state income tax to $6,000 by the present administration. Be it therefore resolved, first, that the Mississippi AFL-CIO and convention assembled July 27, 1970, go on record as favoring a revision of the state income law to provide an $8,000 exemption. Be it further resolved that the intent of this resolution be implemented by drawing up a bill with the proper language and presented to the proper legislative committee chairman for pre-filing in keeping with new streamlining procedures of the legislature. Be it finally resolved that in the event the legislature fails to pass this or similar legislation in its regular session of 1971, that this will become an evaluating item in the screening of candidates asking for office in the state election in 1971.
You want to move the adoption of that resolution?
Motion for the adoption of this resolution.
I second.
Brother Taylor, didn't you admit the word tax, income tax law? You omitted the word tax, I believe. Income tax law.
Well, this subject to revision, this is hastily put together.
We have a second to that motion to adopt that resolution.
Yes.
Second.
Before we take it up for discussion, let me say that the bill along this line was introduced and passed by the Senate. It was introduced and sponsored by Ellis Bodron from Vicksburg. It's almost identical to what you suggested, but it died in the House Ways and Means Committee during the last session. So you do have support already in the legislature part, what I'm trying to tell you. All right, we have any discussion? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. And we will refer that resolution to the legislative committee also. Brother Schaefer, you are going to have some work to do. Now, you got another resolution, I believe, that you wanted also presented.
This would be resolution number 13. Whereas, due to the failure of the United States Senate to confirm the appointment of Justice A. Porter to Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court, based largely on a conflict of interest situation, keep that conflict of interest uppermost in mind. And whereas members of the National Congress, having the light of public opinion turned on them as a result of this episode, are becoming increasingly sensitive to their own possible conflicts of interest, having begun some degree of corrective legislation. And whereas at the state level, the legislative body is composed of a cross-section of membership, which in some cases stands to personally gain or lose if certain pieces of legislation is passed or fails to pass, which constitutes a gross personal conflict of interest. It is commonly known that a large number of members of both the Senate and the House of Representatives are lawyers who are employed by corporations, oil companies, banks, insurance companies, trucking companies, loan companies, and so forth. The list could go on and on. And whereas this relationship constitutes a threat to our democratic processes, causing the vested moneyed interest to be protected at the expense of common people, which is definitely not in the public interest, be it therefore resolved. First, that a law be passed providing that upon taking the oath of office as a member of the Senate and our House of Representatives of the State of Mississippi, that the Secretary of State be furnished information on the nature of any outside employment, family farming excluded, involving an amount of money or goods equal to $500 minimum. And we might also add having stock in companies of a similar amount. This information to be filed and made part of the public record. And we have also added that if this fails, that it will be an evaluating question and qualifying candidates running for office in the state election. I'll make the motion that this resolution likewise be adopted.
Is there a second to that?
I'll second.
I'd like to add one question. You want the executive board to submit them? I mean,
they'll be submitted. You want to submit it by the executive board?
As far as I'm concerned, just so it gets.
You want them?
Just so it's accepted. If you want to do the same thing you did in the tax committee, or you want to put your stamp of approval on it, it's immaterial to me.
I assume that you wanted them to submit it by the board to get them adopted by the board and submitted.
Well, I think that would probably be in keeping with the provisions of the Constitution on the presentation of the resolution.
And I might say this is a very good resolution, and I'm in complete agreement with it.
No question what you said
is absolutely
correct. Legislation that the State Farm Association has been trying to get passed for several years, and some of the municipalities, municipal association has a paid man up there. It's really been a thorn in our side, and when this comes before the whatever committee it is, well, I'm sure they'd like to meet with them.
Well, you know, the municipalities, I'm a senator serving in the Mississippi Senate.
I'm very well aware of that.
Municipal Association, Senator Garway from Leland. You know, he's not only on their payroll, he's a member of the doggone Senate. And of course, what he says is very true about many, many members. George Payne Cosser is a good example, chairman of the Rules Committee, who's on the retainer fee by all, I don't know how many of these corporations.
That ought not to be.
No, right. All right, we're having a discussion on that resolution. Ready for the question? All in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Now, Brother Schaefer, you've got several resolutions, and I'm going to see if I can't work out something with one of the other committees to handle that last resolution where you want out of submitting. The resolutions committee's got two. Educational committee's got one. Brother Robbins, how about your committee handling that resolution? You only got one to handle. Let's put that one in.
He said he'd just take that one himself. It sounded good. He said he'd just take that one himself. It sounded so good.
Can we put number 12 legislative?
I would like to be in position to implement it.
And number 13 in education, is that all right with everybody? All right. That resolution, which will become number 13, will be put to education. Yeah, and I might tell you, Brother Robbins and Brother Schaefer, if you will, put those two on the top of your list and dispose of them as soon as you can and bring them to Miss Phillips so she cuts stencils and get them run off. Would you do that? See which one?
Four.
Bob, we want you and Edwards to get together. Resolution number 4 ought to be brought up and disposed of before resolution number 5, which deals with the special legislative fund. We all get together on this, and we want yours called up first and his right behind it.
Here's the fault.
Because one of them is, you know, the one of them policy of them is for the implementation.
In other words, with the adoption of this, the convention commits itself to provide the finances for the program, and then number 5 provides the finance.
Right.
Right.
So y'all gonna ring him.
Now let me see. Do we have anything else we need to? There's one other thing that we are about that we'd be good to do that you might want to approve or disapprove here this afternoon. You know, we've got the automobile tags, the union wages, buy more, and we are proposing that we give a tag to each delegate that buys a Coke ticket, so there might be an incentive to buy Coke tickets. So if this does not meet your approval, now's the time to let yourself be heard.
Will the tags cost 75 cents?
Well, this is what the cost is.
I know what I mean, it'll go.
About the cost.
Well, actually, you're going to come out 25 cents.
We'll make a little out of it, but the thing is that we'll maybe encourage him to buy Coke tickets, you see, and that meets your approval?
Yeah.
All right. That's all I have on the agenda.
I got one thing.
I will see if any of you got something. Okay, Brother Clark.
I don't know if it's been any rain, but maybe Tuesday night. I think CWA has always kind of sponsored a little get together, you know? And I just wondered if anybody thought about that for this.
Well, we can make arrangements, I think, for the place. What do you think?
If it's necessary, we could take up the collection or whatever to finance the thing.
Well, we'll put you and the two board members in charge of entertainment. You can be responsible for it. Is that good enough?
Now.
Well, the clerk is not jamming to the entertainment.
Just before we dismiss, I'd like to say that it's been a pleasure to work with the board for the last few years. And I'm not coming up for election, but anytime I can help any of you, feel free to call on me. I'm still going to do all I can for the labor movement.
Well, I think I can speak for the rest of the board, Brother Dees, that we've all enjoyed our association with you and the cooperation that we've received. We appreciate that very much.
And the reason is I'm on construction and I'll be traveling out of the state and in the state, and I just don't feel like that a board member should be in the state. And he should be knowing what's going on at all the time in the state, and my position will be that I won't be, so therefore I think that somebody else ought to replace me, and I'm sure they will. It's been a pleasure working with everyone of
you. We have anybody else now, Brother Schaefer? We'll be seeing you, old buddy. We ain't gonna forget about you.
I feel this really should come from the president rather than me, since he's been involved in other things. I'll attempt bring my point. We were supposed to have a resolution here today for the executive board to consider as being presented from the executive board from the Jackson CLU relative to a burn unit and the new Baptist Hospital, which is on the drawing board in Jackson now. The administrators of the Jackson Baptist Hospital has approached labor in the Jackson area to support a fund drive to equip this unit to the tune of $250,000, $250,000. This would be almost unique in the South, especially the Southeast. There is no burn unit west, short of Galveston, Texas, and this is where a lot of Mississippi people, critical cases are carried. There is a partial unit in Mobile, Alabama. It's nothing to compare with what they project for Jackson. They have made an appeal to labor. Some unions have taken some position on it, mine for one, have made a pledge, and the pledge can be prorated out over a 5-year period. They have set September 1st
as the deadline date for commitments. Now, the reason for this is that the plans are still in the hands of an architect, and there has to be some alterations made in basic plans in order to incorporate this into the intensive care unit. Actually, what it will be an ward of isolation that burn patients are carried into. They don't leave this every need that they would have through the period of hospitalization and convalescence would be within this unit. The only exposure to germs, which is the greatest detriment that a burn patient has, is to the personnel going and coming in and out of this unit. The rest of it, once you're in, it's there. It's not out of one ward into another ward and back into the burn unit. And of course, the special provisions for handling these burn patients. This is the expensive item. Frankly, it's a real good thing. We would like to see it in the state of Mississippi, not necessarily in Jackson. None of us never know who might be next. In the electric utility industry, do have some people burn occasionally. Last year, we had too many burns. But the housewife and the children are actually exposed more to the hazard of fire, and many other building trades people are. Your painters has a real hazard. Of course, your firefighters has a real hazard of burning, or exposure to the hazard of burning. So we wanted, and actually what has transpired up to this point, other than, as I mentioned, the local union, personal participation, is that we feel that if labor wants to do it, it should have an endorsement of the AFL-CIO convention first. Then, of course, where the interest is greater would be in the vicinity of Jackson because of the immediate care that they would give to this particular area. So what we were hoping to do would be get full labor endorsement for it with pledges to carry it back to their organizations and solicit funds for it with the Jackson Central Labor Union actually carrying the ball for the labor movement, generally speaking. So Claude has been in one meeting which I have not been in, and I'm sure he would like to have.
Well, I'm certainly in complete accord with this, and it was my understanding, Jack, that the Jackson Central Labor Union was going to submit a resolution on this.
For some reason, this is what George came in to tell me. He has put two more emphases on it this week. Of course, Paul Bruton's the man who was going to draft it.
Yeah.
And for some reason, George has had hindrances that he did not get the resolution prepared.
Well, can't we get a committee of Jackson people to draft that resolution, and we could submit it in the name of the executive board, and we'll get somebody to write it up. Would it be possible?
Do that.
It'll be very busy, I know, but we could get George Johnson and a few other people that's familiar with this thing to, we could adopt a motion here to go on record in support of the Burns Center. And then somebody to draft this resolution and submit that to the convention. Would this be in line with what you want to try to do and get it before the convention?
Well, if the board thinks that it's appropriate matter for the convention to take action,
I say
we're ready.
Bart, I belong to an organization which is a shrine that, which he's talking about, this hospital in Galveston, Texas. That whole complete thing is free to the patients, you know. Of course, it's got to be children, up to 15 years of age. They crippled or if they have burned, make no difference, race, creed, or color. If they get burned, they'll take them out there and won't talk to any in the world, and they'll completely get them over and everything. They're the most modern, up-to-date in the world in this thing.
Yeah.
And this one, I think, is good that since this, it don't go on beyond children, that this would be good to support something like this for the people.
Well, something that's close by with, you know, as they tell me in this meeting in our tent, that sometimes just a few minutes means the difference in life and death on these severely burned cases. I don't think there's any question about the need of it, really. But if you like, somebody like to offer a motion that we, that the executive board go on record in support of the burn center and the
I'll offer that motion.
And then we'll get somebody to try to draw up the resolution, submit it in the name of the executive board. Brother McDaniel,
I'll offer that motion.
I second.
All right, we have any further discussion? Jack, when we get it on the floor, we'll get you and maybe George to get a comment on this.
Let me say one other thing, and Claude, I know what you say there, time is important thing. I can cite you one case where time cost a life there in Meridian. I mean, the potentate of Massa Temple got this, they brought this case to his attention. He went out there to see him at the hospital. And I'd say they wasn't equipped for such a thing there at the hospital. So he started to make arrangements to get them to Galveston, Texas. And he called out to the Navy base out there, which they always have good, anytime anything like that comes up, the government either fly them or something like that, you see them in Navy planes. They didn't have one at the Navy base, they didn't have one at the Keesha Field down here they could pick up, but they did have one at Chinook Field in Illinois, a plane that they could send there and pick them up and take them to Galveston, Texas.
Yeah.
So they put an army doctor and nurse on the plane. And the plane stopped over in Birmingham and called Meridian and told him to have them at the hospital, at the airport by the time he could get there. And they jumped in the ambulance and thing, run out there to pick them up to get them to the airport, and the patient died en route to the hospital.
Yeah.
I mean,
this is what I'm talking about. See, this helicopter ambulance service is also important. It's something that, that ties in with this burn center, and I think this is something that we are going to have to get behind to maintain the helicopter ambulance service to get people like this to the hospital as soon as possible. All right, we have that motion that we go on record here in support of the burn center. Do we have any further discussion? If not, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried and so ordered. Now, do you have anything else that anybody wants to bring up before I make my announcement?
Well, if I would like to ask a question.
Yeah.
For a point of information that may be helpful to the Cup Committee and consider further, considering any further resolution if they so desire.
Yeah.
I would like if there to know if there is any board member present here. Know of any county where there has been a redistricting of supervisors where the voter registration books are being purged and everybody has to re-register to vote again.
Do we know of any county that is not going on in?
Yeah.
Well, on just county. About all of them, isn't it?
Washington County.
Well,
this county
is the information that I'd like to know because it's been my understanding that maybe there's some counties that's not going. I guess what we need to do, we need to
poll this convention while we got them together and find out, you know, just how many counties we really got. But my understanding is going on in just about all of them. You know, it will be before next year, that is. Yeah. We have anything else? Well, I got an announcement I want to make before we break up. I have advised Mr. Stanton Smith and some other officials of the AFL-CIO that I can no longer afford to be president of this organization if the salary is presently paying. And that if the salary is not adjusted whereby I can properly perform my obligations to my family, then I will be forced as a matter of necessity to take a job with an international union that will pay the salary that that I feel that I should be getting. I don't want to be misunderstood on this thing. I'm not throwing in the towel. I don't propose to step down as president if I'm reelected. But I thought that you ought to know this, that I've told Mr. Smith that the State FFL-CIO itself is not in a position to
get the salaries of the officers up where they ought to be without increasing per capita tax. And that I would not propose an increase in the per capita tax with this large group of unaffiliated organizations simply to get a salary increase. Therefore, that I felt that the AFL-CIO itself should come up with the necessary funds to get my salary and, of course, Brother Knight's up where they ought to be. I thought you ought to know this before we go into the convention and I'm reelected and we bring this matter up at the board meeting. Brother Smith is working on the matter. He's advised me that that he'll be at the board meeting after the convention and that he thinks he'll be able to work something out. So that was my announcement. I just wanted you to know what the situation is. Okay? I guess everybody here will be standing for re-election. Is anybody besides Brother Dave? You're going to be drafted. We ain't about to let you get out of this thing outside of Brother Dave. Anybody else? Brother Knight, you got anything you want to say before we adjourn?
No, other than, of course, as always, it's been a pleasure to work with this board and to have all the brothers.
Are you soliciting from their support?
Well, you know, I don't know how to put it, I would appreciate it. Good night.
Okay, if there's nothing else, good luck to all of you. We'll see you on the platform in the morning.
9:30.